meeting of September 26, 2011. If you'd all stand for the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And if you'd all please stay standing for a quick moment of silence for men and women serving us abroad and at home. Thank you. Please be seated. Okay. Public comment. We have nothing in public comment tonight, so that leaves it up to the people in the audience. If you have any comments or anything you want to bring before us tonight before we get started. Vinny?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Vinny Curran, 103 High Range Road. Just wanted to say, Saturday we held our 11th annual Family Safety Day in town. It was also our first year with the Moose Hill PTA doing a fundraiser. They did the Touch a Truck fundraiser, and the entire community came together, and it was just an outstanding event. Everyone from the school district, highway, the police, fire, everybody came together. We had like 17 or 18 different trucks for the fundraiser. It was awesome. I don't have numbers from there, but real quick to give you, we inspected 21 car seats that day. None were correct. We took two out of service. We donated two to the families that we took those out of service from. The New Hampshire Freemasons processed 42 children through their child ID program, so hopefully we can make them safer. The Injury Prevention Center from Dartmouth Hitchcock Medical Center came down with their brand new distracted driving simulator. We had 30 of our young adults go through that. All have recently got their license, and every single one of them crashed through at least one of the two simulations that they did. One was distracted driving, where they were told a voice in the video tells you to dial a certain number on your phone or text a certain number while you were driving. The other one was a drunken driving simulator. At least every one of the young adults that went through it crashed on at least one of the simulators. So it was a great day, and thank you to the council for supporting us and the entire community. Everybody came together, and it was a great day. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Vinny. Excellent job. Okay. We did have some business that came up over the weekend. Instead of keeping the school board members that are here in attendance, I'd like to review it real quick if the council will entertain that. This is in regards to Friday night coverage for football.
Oh, I didn't hear about this.
Yeah. John? If you guys would step up to the mic for a minute, we'd just go through that real quick so you guys don't have to wait. I'm not sure how long we're going to be with the business at hand.
Appreciate that. It looks like you might have a long night. Hi, I'm John Robinson, 13 Elwood Road.
Nancy Hendricks, 14 King John Drive.
So I had received a phone call Friday evening in regards to coverage for the football game, for the Lancer football game on Friday. And I guess it was kind of a last minute. The school board had heard that they weren't going to have an ambulance on the field in case of any kind of emergencies that might come up. So it was basically put to the school board that if they didn't discuss that they were going to be able to pay for the ambulance that night, there wouldn't be coverage. So I'm kind of, I was concerned that we didn't provide the proper notification to the school board for my first concern, and then the second one is, what are we going to do to resolve this going forward? So I'll ask you, Dave.
Maybe the chief can give us a little background as to how this issue came about.
Ambulance coverage is not a requirement of NIAA or the school in general. When we were contacted earlier, and our usual, we've been able to provide it before up until this round of budget issues, because it comes out of my budget, basically. We've been able to cover it. This year, when we talked with the athletic director earlier on in August, I said that we could not provide a dedicated ambulance to be there at all times because it had to come out of my budget, and gave them the offer that they could hire like a detail, like they hire the police officers to to cover it. That didn't apparently happen at the time. So I offered that we could, at least if the ambulance was not busy at the time, we just couldn't dedicate it there. We could put it over there, and if we needed to pull it, we would pull it at that point. And that's basically how we got to be where it was. And I just reiterated that because the week before they had been able to go over there okay, and I said, because we were short-staffed on this Friday night, we might not be able to stay there for the whole entire game. So I wanted to reiterate that to the athletic director and to the school department, which was Nate Greenberg at the time. So
my question, I guess, going back to the incident is, from what I talked to John about, is they didn't know about it until Friday. So I'm kind of wondering what we could do differently so that this kind of doesn't blindside them. I mean, you know.
We've always dealt directly with the athletic director, and they've always made the request. So we just offered that to them as an alternative and said, we'll go if we can, but we cannot dedicate an ambulance and two EMTs to the football games based on the budget.
May I ask a question?
Absolutely.
Was the ambulance there Friday night?
Yes.
The school also offered to pay for it.
So our ambulance was there Friday night?
Yes.
Did we have to leave at any point?
Not that I'm aware of. I didn't see it on the list, so.
Okay, so as long as we don't have a call, we have people available to drive the ambulance, right?
That's correct.
And as long as you don't have a call, they're not going to park over at Central and, you know, do whatever they're doing over at Central waiting for a call. They're going to go over and park at the football field.
That's what we did, yes.
Okay.
But there's no guarantee. I mean, it may...
Well, we might get a call and we got to go.
Or it might not have gotten there if they were out, so.
And then we'd have to call mutual aid, or we'd have to send EMTs from the Central Firehouse.
If they were available.
Or from south or from north. Okay, so if the ambulance has to leave, can we, if someone's at south or north who's an EMT, can they go to the football field?
Assuming we have an ambulance available, if there's both the ambulances are out, we don't have...
Chief, I don't know how to run a fire department. They could take the engine. They could sit there with the engine, right? And then if the ambulance is needed, we'll call Derry, we'll call whoever we got to call. But somehow, some way, we can probably support the football game 5 nights a year. I'm just asking, Chief. I'm not trying to put you on the hot seat.
I would say that if somebody was available, that there would be somebody there. The whole idea was having the ambulance there was to be able to take them and transport them in an earlier fashion than waiting for an ambulance to come there that was from out of town.
Understood. So I guess what I'm asking is that I don't think the school board wants to incur any more costs. We don't want to incur any more costs. We're all sensitive to it. Would the school board be open to a scenario where if an engine is available and the ambulance has to leave for a reason and the engine comes to back the, would they be open to that scenario and having to wait, I guess is the question I'm moving towards.
Mm-hmm. And I hear what you're saying. So I guess we'll throw it back to you, John, and to you, Nancy.
Sure, thank you. I think that the school district is simply looking to ensure or to promote the safety of the people at the game, primarily the players. The chief is right that NHIAA does not require this, but it is something that the school has done, and most schools, in fact, do, just because it appears to be the right thing to do. My understanding was that the first time that the district office heard about this request was Friday. So I'm going to have to look into whether the athletic director heard about it and whether there was a breakdown somewhere in that chain. But I think that our staffs, if David could correct me if I'm wrong, my understanding is the superintendent has spoken with the town manager about it, and our staffs are beginning to look at it. And, you know, if there is a detail cost or something like that, if that works out to be the best solution, then we as a town and a school district should be able to find a way to work it out together. You know, the one thought that comes to my mind is, as you and I discussed, Sean, it's the proverbial single pair of pants. You can take it out of the school side, you can take it out of the town side. I'm not sure I see the need for the accounting overhead of us, you know, sending you guys a check for 320 times five games every year, but, you know, whatever has to get worked out gets worked out.
All right, so to John's question, maybe you could discuss this with the school board, so that we try to avoid that. If the chief and staff can't provide an ambulance, would it be okay if they had a truck parked over there or whatever that may be?
I used to be an EMT myself. I worked when I lived in Goffstown. I worked there. I think that primarily what we'd be wanting would be to have trained people, professional people with some degree of professional equipment. I mean, I think the chief could back me up. If you had a suspected neck trauma at a football game, by the time your engine crew got somebody packaged up, there'd be a rig there to take them off to Parkland. So I would think that if that were the outcome, that would be acceptable. It would be something that, you know, I'd certainly want to pass by Nate and Howard Soboloff as well. But, you know, working within the constraints of the current fiscal times, as long as we're able to take care of the kids if they get hurt, that's what we're looking for.
Mr. Chairman, could I? Yes, go ahead. Just to clarify, though, I think that we did say that the ambulance would be parked on those nights at the field, and if we did get a call, I want to make sure that that's very clear, that if we did get a call, then obviously the ambulance would leave. In the back, this, we're talking about the backup, so I want to make sure it's clear that step one is that when there's a game, that ambulance will be there.
I think that's to be worked out between the chief and that. And then the other part of that would be if the ambulance does leave, that there would be somebody there to be a presence. I think that's what we're talking about.
I think
about.
What Joe's asking is the ambulance goes now, right?
Right.
Yes.
Yeah.
So you guys go now, right? So if you don't have a call, you're there when the game starts.
We offered, first of all, they asked for a dedicated ambulance to be there.
Understood.
I could not dedicate an ambulance to be there with two guys based on my budget.
And if you're not busy, they're going to be there, though.
That was the alternative that I approached with them, and they seemed fine with that. But again, on Friday, I wanted to reiterate the fact that they understood that because of last Friday, we were short-staffed to start with.
Okay.
Which means that we're...
Understood.
We couldn't necessarily be there.
But you'll take every necessary... So what you're saying is the fire department... I'm just checking for understanding. What you're saying is the fire department will make every effort to have the ambulance there, and if you have to leave, make every effort to back up whatever we need to back up for the football game so that a qualified professional is available there at the game.
We'll do the best we can.
Of course, there is the extreme circumstance. I mean, I think everybody would understand
that. You have to understand that I can't strip the town either in the process.
I mean, we could have a 30-car pileup on 93, yeah, and then it really doesn't matter at that.
I don't think we're talking about that, though. We're talking about standard, and I agree with you, John. We're talking about standard operating procedure. That's SOP. In other words, the SOP for that night would be the ambulance is not parked at Central, it's parked at the field, and that's what I'm asking for.
I think he's telling us he's doing that.
Well,
I don't get a sense of that. That's what I suggested
as an alternative method to do that. Okay. If the ambulance was available, we would park it over there.
Good.
Okay.
So, Tom, you had a question. Go ahead.
Yeah. All right, so we all know the ambulance is there if it's available. Good.
Okay, go ahead.
How much are we talking for one game for a detail?
At $64 an hour per person times a minimum of 4 hours, same as detail as a police officer.
How many?
We were told $320 an hour, or for the night. Isn't that right?
You'd have to pay a minimum for
right,
4 hours
right,
per person.
That's right. Yeah. 320.
I think that. These are all great ideas, and I appreciate you guys thinking them up and discussing them with us. I think that one thing that I can't say, because I'm in the same role you are, I don't run school, you know, an athletic department, is whether the staff feels strongly that a dedicated ambulance is necessary. And if they do, I think I'm hearing a willingness from your side to find a way to work it out. You know, will whatever financial arrangements have to be made can get made.
I think, you know, from what I'm hearing from the council is I think that there's definitely some solutions on the table. We just need to have staff work together to be able to come up with that, whatever that solution is, and make sure that it's amicable to both boards. But to me, this is definitely a pretty easily solvable thing. To me, that's just my one opinion. So
I've already stated sort of where I stand. I think Chief has stated where he stands.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So.
It just, if I may, Mr. Chairman, it just was a great concern of mine that evening when I heard that a football game was not going to be covered. When I got the communication, it was a football game that was not going to be covered with an ambulance, and that was where my concern started to rise, and that's why I made as many phone calls as I did. So I think we did resolve it. We clarified a few things. I think we need to check with the August versus the Friday communication, but I was told that we didn't know anything about it. Friday, there's no ambulance. What are we going to do? Well, we got to make sure that that doesn't happen in the future. That's what we got to make sure that we do. So.
And just to wrap it up, I think, is in my world, this kind of thing happens because there wasn't a communication in place. It seemed like there was maybe a little less affair that went on, and it was just assumed from both sides that, you know, there would be something they had to protect, and then something came up. Either way, somebody didn't communicate to the school board that this was going to happen. I don't know where the blame is, and I'm not looking for a blame. All I'm looking to do is try to fix it so that we don't have to worry about it going forward, and there's some kind of a plan that you guys are okay with.
I think definitely that's what we're looking to do, and if the communication breakdown does turn out to be on our side, then let me apologize in advance for whatever
like
potential
I said, John,
contribution we might have made.
There's no apology necessary because this conversation needed to happen, so we're
great.
Yep, we're good.
Thanks very much.
So,
thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Okay, any other public comment? Okay. Seeing none, we have nothing for public hearing. So we're going to go to old business. So we have the appointments to the Public Safety Dispatch Services Study Committee. So with that said, we'll bring it back to the council. So we compiled the list of the applicants that came out last Monday, and we did appreciate the sincere amount of people that came forward, all very well qualified, and which I kind of thought was great that they came forward to, you know, want to be part of this process and, you know, give the citizens input and all that stuff. So to basically go into a little bit of the detail, what we did was the council had each decided that night that we were going to pick one person. I sat on the sidelines and basically we just compiled everything. And the council each gave me one pick of who they would like to see as a rep for the committee. And we also have two alternates that will sit for the meetings. And if somebody can't make it, then they can step forward and have a, you know, a vote in whatever gets, you know, voted on that evening.
So, Mr. Chairman, please clarify, they are a full participant, they're just not a voting member unless
somebody... Unless somebody says, yeah, exactly. I think that makes the most sense. That way we keep it active and, you know, sometimes we all know as these committees get set up, there's a lot of people with good intention, but sometimes life gets in the way and you can't attend every meeting. So, anyway, so with that said, what we decided on was, I have the list somewhere in here. As you can tell, I'm not as prepared as I usually am. Or try to be.
Go back. That's not it, because mine's not on
there.
Yeah,
that's not it. Okay. Anyway, so I believe what we decided was this. Going back to my mindset here, Councilor Dolan approved John Beliquet. Councilor Farrell. Oh, perfect. Thank you. Okay, there it is. All right. Council Farrell chose Linda Germain. Joe chose Steve Chasen. Tom Frieda chose Ed Nolan. Tom Dolan chose John Beliquet. And the alternates that we picked, by virtue of two councilors picking the same people, was Bradley Osgood, and Brendan Burns. And that's what we ended up with for the picks. So with that said, bring it up to the council. First off, I'd like to say thank you to everybody that came forward, and we'll be sending out thank you letters, which I have in front of me. And we appreciate you coming forward, and we encourage you to keep doing that, as we'll have plenty of things, I'm sure, coming fast and furious. So bring it back to the council. I'm sure there's going to be questions over who picked who, and it's
stop the discussion.
And one question I have, Joe, if you could lend some insight. I've never met Mr. Chasen. We didn't interview him. He's not on the list from our minutes. Did you speak with him, or can you lend any insight on why he would be good for the committee?
Yeah, I just think that he had...
Ask him his opinions.
Based on letter, the letter that he wrote, I think he has a lot of experience in fire departments and emergency services with 13 years, a paramedic, police officer, volunteer firefighter. He's also likes different types of systems. He's seen he's seen some success with regional emergency systems as well. I think he has some great background as far as the amount of time that he's been in working this type of business. So that's pretty much the reason.
Did you get a chance to talk to him?
No, I hadn't. Nope.
So we didn't get a chance to ask him if he has a conflict of interest or anything along those lines. So you don't think he has one?
No. No.
I will say this, that I have had some interaction with him. I haven't spoken to him directly. But he, back when we started the process of looking at the dispatch services thing, Steve was very vocal and sent me emails, as well as Dave, challenging us to look at things and, you know, think outside the box. So I think he offers a good perspective.
That's all well and good, and maybe he does. But other people came down and were interviewed, and I just think in the interest of fairness, there's people we're telling them that we're not interested yet. Someone we haven't met, we haven't spoken to, is someone we want to put on the committee. And that's fine. That's the prerogative of this council. But that's just to bring that out. It'd be nice if he would come down and talk to us at some point.
I think he sent an email offering to do that. He couldn't make it at the last meeting.
He couldn't make it tonight either, but he volunteered to come in at any other time.
So if we have meetings, we better not have meetings on Monday nights, or else he won't be able to make it.
Well, you know,
That's a joke,
I understand, but you know, I think he can speak for himself on things. But you know, I think we entered a process, John, where all the councilors were given a pick. I didn't know people's picks were going to be, you know, have to be justified. I mean, if you want, I can justify mine, you know.
I don't have a problem with yours. He came down here, he was interviewed, we all talked to him. I actually don't have a problem with Steve. I was just curious about why someone none of us met, what we thought was different about him than the others, then we wouldn't pick them. But, hey, that's okay. I mean, it's only one position. The guy volunteered. It's fine. Just curious.
Okay. Okay. Any other comments, questions?
Yes, I would have liked to have been able to ask him the question I asked all the candidates, and that was, would he be able to keep an open mind regardless of how the discussion went in either direction? And so I guess I don't know the answer to that question. So I don't know, Joe, were you able to ask him that question?
No, but we didn't make it a requirement of the picks to have an interview. We asked people to come down. Some people could not because of prior commitments. And I think this person's qualified, and I had one pick, so I think we should move on.
I understand. I just wondering if you had any insight.
This is not a debate.
Whether he had
With all due respect, Mr. Chairman, we're not having a debate. We're just asking a question.
I just wondering if you
had... Not trying to be rude, just trying to ask a question.
If you had any insight based on your discussions or relationship, whether you thought he would be able to meet that requirement that I was looking for?
No, I don't.
I have a question.
Go ahead.
Are we now going to inquire as to other groups to pick people, for example, the school board, the budget committee, about whether they had positions that are hot and fast and not going to be consider any of the facts?
If you want to, go ahead.
No, I'm just asking, is that where we're going with this? Because
I'm not going anywhere with it. I just asked if he spoke to the man. Maybe he could lend some insight. I don't know the man. You're asking me to vote for somebody I don't know anything about and haven't met, and I met the others.
We're not asking to vote for anybody. We have one pick each. So
no, we have to make a motion. Okay. And we have to vote as a council whether who accept these folks.
That's fine.
And I have to vote. So I'm just asking. If you don't know the answer, fine. You know, that's fine. I don't have any, there's no problem with it. I'm not saying I'm not going to vote for the guy. Just asking. I don't think it's, you know, I don't think it's outside of the realm of asking, geez, we're going to nominate somebody. We're going to put him on. And nobody's ever met the guy or talked to him. Yet, we met all the other people we're going to put on. I thought it was kind of weird. So, I asked. asked and answered.
Okay. I think that's pretty much said all we got to say on that. All right, so let's, can someone make a motion?
Sean, it's your call, Sean.
Can you name them again a little slower this time? A little clearer, let's put it that way.
Okay. As compiled, we have Linda German, Steve Chasen, Ed Nolan, John Veliquette. The alternates were Bradley Osgood and Brendan Burns.
So make a motion that we accept the nominations as read.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion passes 5-0. Okay. All right, so the business at hand, from what most, probably 99.9% of the people here tonight, is the Hemlock Structure Fire Workshop. We have staff here from the fire department that did a post-incident analysis that we are going to review tonight. They're going to give us their input. The council will then ask some questions. They'll answer the questions, and we'll probably open it up to the public, I'm sure, if there are any questions from them, too. So anyway, gentlemen, if you could start us off.
Hi, Captain Jim Roger. Mr. Chairman, Council, thank you very much for letting us come here tonight to make this presentation here.
Thanks, Jim. I appreciate you guys coming in.
Captain Douglas Cardwell, thank you.
Chief Kevin McCaffrey. And our technician is paramedic Bruce Hollowell.
Thanks for coming in, guys. I know it was a tough night for many people. A lot of people lost friends, family, and you guys had a rough night having to pick up the pieces. So if you could take us down that night and kind of bring us back to, touch on the report and what you guys feel and consider are key things that we should know.
Mr. Chairman, what we've done is put together a PowerPoint presentation to really paint the picture of that night behind you. There's going to be telephone audio. There's going to be audio transmissions, communications from the fire alarm to the scene. And basically, this is going to illustrate what happened that night, the time that took place, and the actions which occurred. So we can go just slide by slide right through. After that, we'd like to bring up the post-incident analysis report, and at that time, give the council any questions on the report itself. I know it was pretty comprehensive. And right behind you, as you see, 38 Hemlock Street was a two-story wood frame construction. It was built in 1986, 8 rooms, 4 bedrooms, local fire alarms. The utilities were underground, finished basement. And the bulkhead was a means of egress. What you can see with the garage is over the bedroom. So very contemporary, very large, large house and dwelling. It's tough to see exactly where that hydrant is, but the distance, the water supply was an issue that night, and the distance of the hydrant is 890 feet from Hemlock Street. The hydrant is actually located in the town of Derry itself. Again, with the lights, if you look, probably about 3 house lots up is where the hydrant is. That's where the town line is going to be. Yep, right in that area. So the hydrant was located in Derry. Therefore, the computerized system red alert designated it to be a hydrant district with that. The hydrant pressure, one thing we know with this hydrant, sometimes terminology in a report like this, it's a dead-end hydrant. Being a dead-end hydrant means it's the last one in the loop. Being the last one in the loop, it's not fed by multiple grids. Those particular hydrants are usually low on pressure and usually need a fire engine to boost the pressure with that. Also, being the location, known location, a tanker was also requested by the first new engine company, knowing that there would probably be a water supply problem just because of the location of the hydrant itself. If you look at our the way our stations are located, to respond to the Hemlock Street area, Station 2, we're looking at 17 Young Road, 2.3 miles away, traveled. Central Station, 3.9, 10-minute travel. All these times are times that are going to come through just MapQuest. And then on another slide, we're actually going to have the actual response times. And then we're looking at Station 1, you know, 8.3, which could be an 18-minute drive with that. At this time, I just our mutual aid partners that responded that night, before we go any further, because I'm afraid I'm going to go into depth later and forget to thank them, the Derry Fire Department, the Litchfield Fire Department, Wyndham, Hudson, they all did a fantastic job that night in assisting us with mutual aid. So I'd just like to publicly thank them for their assistance that night. Also, kind of when it's a fire scenario, we forget about the police. The police, Londonderry Police Sergeant Jason Breen, I was the incident commander for the fire. He came right over to me. We formed a unified command together, and you know, basically, Cap, what can we do for you? They did an excellent job that night. They evacuated the house behind. They also helped care for the Gehling family, you know, while we were involved in a rescue operation. So just as always, when we have an incident with the Londonderry Police, we join together very well, and we have a great working relationship with them. It's tough to see the times. I thought he was going to be able to read that a little better with some of the times. Bruce, if you could just read those off.
Wyndham was approximately 11 minutes. Derry Central Station, which is the one on East Broadway, is 11 minutes. Derry Station 4, which is on Hampstead Road, was 13 minutes. Derry Station 3 on English Range Road was 15 minutes. Derry Station 2 on Warner Hill Road is 17 minutes. Hudson Fire Central Station, which is the one located right in the center of town on Library Street, is 20 minutes travel time. And then Litchfield Fire Department on Charles Bancroft Highway was a 23-minute travel time. And again, that's all under normal driving conditions, no lights and sirens. That would be your normal driving time.
Okay, thank you. The weather that night, it was a rainy night. It was about 45 degrees. Temperature was 45. The wind was 10 miles an hour, kind of a humid night. Time of the call was 4:21. At that particular night, we had a staffing at 10. When we talk about staffing, it's confusing sometimes. Chief McCaffrey just spoke about dropping to 9. What he means when he talks about 9, a captain and 8 firefighters. Okay, so 2 firefighters are paramedics, and that's what the staffing is. That particular night, we had a captain and 9 firefighters, so a staffing of 10. Station 1 is a lieutenant and 2 firefighters. Central Station is a lieutenant, 3 firefighters, and a captain. And Station 2 is going to be a lieutenant and a firefighter. That's a 2-man company. Typically, our first line assignment is going to give us, you know, 3 engine companies, engines 2, 3, 1, the aerial truck, and the commander, the shift commander that's in a car. A lot of times, if we're en route to a scene and we get information updates, we will go to the next assignment, which is a working fire assignment. That'll give us the closest engine and ambulance to come to the scene and our rescue truck, which is currently unstaffed. Just to highlight what we talk about, when we say unstaffed, the one ambulance is staffed at Central Station, the other ambulance is cross-manned. So Rescue 1, Truck 1, Engine 3, and the second ambulance are cross-manned by the other two people. It's not fully staffed, so they're cross-manned, just so we understand that. Second alarm gives us Derry Truck, Hudson Engine, Litchfield. That particular night, we called for extra resources, an additional Derry engine, 2 additional medic units, and a Litchfield tanker. Pretty much a timeline that's going to go through. Bruce is going to play pretty much right from the call to the initial dispatch and kind of illustrate the timeline that happened.
So this is the first 911 caller, was an occupant of Hemlock Street.
Army Fire, would you emergency?
911-8160, caller report your porch on fire, 38 Hemlock Street in Londonderry.
38 Hemlock?
Yes.
Okay, get everybody out of the house, we're on our way.
Okay, we're trying.
Okay, and it says 38 Hemlock Street, right?
Yes.
Okay, we're on our way.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, bye-bye.
At this time, you notice he reported a porch fire. When I came downstairs and asked dispatch, what do we have? He says, Cap, we got a porch on fire. We know that area, that response time is roughly an 8-minute response time from past calls going there. So as an incident commander, I'm thinking probably upon arrival, porch fire, it's going to start getting in the house, maybe have a couple of rooms going. But with our complement, we should be able to get a knockdown.
Did you say whose voice? I believe that was the... Daughter-in-law. Son's wife was the first 911 caller.
They were in the basement?
They were from the basement, correct.
The first call was actually made from the daughter-in-law from the driveway. The mother and father had thrown a cell phone out the front window to her and told her to dial 911 because the porch was on fire.
From 420 to 421, that's the drop down from 911. Our dispatcher speaking with the caller, and then at 421 is when the tone went out.
Company for a building fire, 3838 Hemlock Street. Engines 2 and 1, 3, car 2, truck 1. 38 Hemlock Street, report a building fire. Engines 2, 3, and 1, car 2, truck 1. 38 Hemlock Street, report a building fire.
Engine 1 responding.
Engine 1 responding.
Engine 3, truck 1 responding.
Engine 3, truck 1 on.
Engine 2 is responding.
Engine 2 responding. Company's report. Respond to 38 Hemlock Street. Could be the first on the left coming in from Forest Street. P7S2, caller reporting a porch fire. Fire extending to the house.
Car 2 copies.
The next audio recording will be the caller from number 31 Hemlock Street, which is directly across the way.
Hey, would you emergency?
Hi, there is a fire across my street, across the house. I'm at 31 Hemlock Street.
And it's number 38?
Yes.
Right there in the car. We're on our way.
Oh, you are on your way?
Yeah, do you know, can you see if it's extended into the house or not? Or?
Yes, it has. It looks like it's in the front window.
Okay, because we've got a report of a porch fire.
Yep, it's all in the house now.
There's all right, we're on our way.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
After the second 911 call, the dispatcher updated the shift commander of what he had received.
Company, respond to 38 Hemlock. Just got a call from a neighbor across the street. You have a confirmed building fire.
Car 2 copies. Paul, why don't you go ahead with the working fire assignment.
So car 2, going to working fire assignment. Car 2, that'll give you a Windham engine and a Debbie medic to the scene.
Okay. And how about hydrant location? My nearest hydrant in Derry or Londonderry?
Your nearest hydrant will be on the town line on Forest Street, right the Derry, Londonderry town line.
Next slide.
Could you move back the slide?
Is there a way to just turn that light down? Just one second. I'd just like to, if I don't know, somebody's back there.
I wanted to ask, can you explain what's meant, what's in the parentheses there on the bottom paragraph?
Londonderry rescue dispatch, but no personnel left at the central.
Yeah, so that's not like our rescue, with our staffing at Central Station. The rescue truck 1 and engine 3 are cross manned, so when the ambulance goes out and the engine goes out of central, or if the ladder truck and the engine go out, the rescue will be left, and the second ambulance is also left. So really, our staffing at Central Station is one ambulance is primary staffed, or whatever piece of equipment, would it be engine 3 or the truck, whichever is going to be appropriate to take. So in this case, it was truck 1 and engine 3. The second medic and a rescue are left because it's not staffed.
Hey, Vinny, it's okay to sit down right now if you want to stand down for that. Okay. We'll just that way that's way the guys can see the thing and it can also be viewed at home.
The second tone that you heard when they requested the working fire, that's the tone that actually activates everybody's pagers who are not on duty. So that's the notification that off-duty personnel can come in and take that piece of apparatus if they can. We only had one individual come in that night.
So out of all the pages that were sent out, one person came in?
One firefighter came in to take the rescue, correct, and one dispatcher came in.
And that was it?
Actually, Bruce, if you want to play the tones, and then I could just speak on that photograph.
Yep.
Alan, can you spot a tanker on this?
Engine 2 requesting a tanker. We'll get a tanker.
Engine 2 is on scene. Be advised, we do have heavy fire showing from side A of the building.
Engine 2 on scene. Heavy fire showing on side A of the building.
And you can go to the next audio.
What's alarm? We got oxygen trapped in the building. We need two additional EMS units.
Two additional EMS units. You have a dev unit. We'll get you two more.
That's the engine two. Engine two. Engine 2 requested additional medic units because of trapped occupants, thinking that there would be patients. I requested an additional engine from Derry, also to the scene. That picture, if you could just look at that picture for us, again, it's tough to tell in here, but when the companies did arrive on scene, the next slide is what we're going to talk about with that, is they had heavy fire showing all through the front windows, the top windows. They initiated an aggressive attack to try to get inside the house by using an 1¾-inch line, which is a maneuverable line to keep the stairs, and at the same time pulling a 2½-inch line. They knocked down a lot of fire on the second floor and with the hopes to try to get in. At the same time, I did my walk around. As an incident commander, I'm required to do a walk around and actually see exactly what we have from all sides of the building. When as I did my walk around to the rear of the building, it was starting to collapse. The roof was starting to collapse in. There's going to be another thing that's going to be tough to see, I think, in the other photograph, is actually adjoining to that house is a 16x20. In that left corner, there was a 16x20 family room. Family room, 16x20, that had a roof, you know, roof on it, you know, regular, but we didn't even realize it that night because we believe that that was where the origin of the fire, where it had started. The only reason that we knew that it existed later on was as light time started to show daylight, the pylons that actually held it up, and we realized what it was. That's how advanced the fire was upon arrival.
Your slide right before this said 8 minutes. Can you go back to that for a second?
Sure.
8 minutes after arrival, does that mean 8 minutes after the call?
That's 8 minutes upon arrival of the first new company.
So when did you arrive there? At what time?
Engine 2 was on scene at 4:28.
Yeah, it's right there. It says right there, arrived on scene.
Okay,
so that's 8 minutes after the call because it's 4:20.
Yes. So, Jim.
Yes.
I think it's after the call. In your estimation, how involved was the fire on a percentage basis of 10 to 100%?
When I arrived on scene, it was probably at least 80% involved, both first and second floor. And I didn't even know that there was a living space in the back.
So is that 60% involved, 70% involved?
That was 80%.
80% involved when you hit the scene.
Right. The only part of the house, and we'll see probably in the later slide, is over, if you remember the first slide that was shown, over the garage area, uh-huh. That was really the only part that wasn't, that was just pushing heavy black smoke.
So, Captain, I'm sorry, John, I didn't get my answer. 4:28 is what it says. So that means that this picture is at 4:36. Is that what we're saying?
Yes, they're probably that, and that was by Brian Johnson, our fire inspector, fire marshal. He responded, and as soon as he arrived on scene, I asked him to start documenting, do a walk around, and you know, start documenting the scene. That's one good thing about having Brian living in town and close is if he can do that, it can pick up a lot of valuable information to you know, exactly maybe where the fire started, the origin. You know, so basically once he gets on scene, he's already starting that origin and cause is happening right away.
Kevin, could you explain the nomenclature of side A versus side B and so forth?
Sure. Yep, absolutely. What we do geographically, side A is the front of the building. On the left-hand side of the building is side B. the rear of the building is called the Charlie side, and the farmost right-hand side is the Delta side. So we break it up. That way we kind of understand. It's the way we talk, because when we use floors, we will say floor one, floor two. We'll say division one, division two. So if I tell the guys the Charlie side, they know they go to the rear of the building. You know, kind of, it's using the NIMS and incident command system.
Jim, could you please explain speed of fire? Okay, 8 minutes to arrival, 8 minutes later, Brian's taking pictures. Speed of fire.
Speed of fire. A fire is going to double, according to the National Fire Protection Association. It doubles in size every 90 seconds. So every 90 seconds, a fire is doubling in size, left unchecked.
So when you arrived, you said it was 80% involved when you arrived. Brian arrived 8 minutes later. So we're 100% involved when Brian arrives.
Pretty much.
Thank you.
Listen, our dispatcher is going to do an excellent job just by estimating.
I'm sure it's approximately three house lots away, probably, I don't know, I'm just guessing probably 6,800 feet.
And the true distance was 890.
That sounds good. Have the dummy engine weigh in for that hydrant. Command, be advised, you're on channel 2 also. We'll have the dummy lay in from that hydrant.
At this time, we have two occupants trapped in the house. So what the strategy was to have all hands effort committed to rescue. What we were going to do is use the available water on scene. We have 3,000 gallons that we carry with our first two engines. And then we also had the Windham engine that was coming pretty quick. That was the closest engine. So that gave us 4,000 gallons to try to get a quick knockdown and try for any potential quick grab, any quick rescue that we can make. In my discussion with Mr. Gehling that night in the driveway, I said, sir, is everybody out of the house? He said, no, my wife and my daughter are still in there. I said, where was the last location of your wife? And he told me, actually going from that area where you saw her over the garage. So that's where we concentrated on to try to go up the stairs and try to get in there. But by the time I did my walk around, the roof was already starting to fail. So it was untenable at the time. This time is taking everybody who's working on the fire ground, putting them on a separate channel, and then that way dispatch can keep bringing in mutual aid companies, giving them directions. Fire alarm did an incredible job that night, not only estimating where the water supply was, how close, but also guiding. I think the next slide, he actually guides the mutual aid companies into the scene. He did a tremendous job.
Come in. Command, answering.
a Hudson engine, Litchfield engine, Litchfield tanker, Windham engine, and a tail of the ambulance also en route.
Okay, file them. Cancel the film ambulance, okay? Jerry truck and stage way out in the street somewhere.
Cancel the Salem ambulance and you'll have the Jerry truck stage on first.
Just for terminology, a truck is a ladder truck. Engines are pumpers. Rescues are traditionally heavy rescues, like we, you know, that carry jaws of life, that type of thing. There are some communities, Salem calls their ambulances rescues. Community of Derry and our community call our ambulances medic units. Mm. So if you see some of the terminology change, like, you know, Jim's canceling the Salem rescue, he's actually canceling an ambulance. So that terminology changes from community to community, but it's just what we're familiar with. So.
Approximately what time was that photo taken?
That photo is approximately, we'll call that 4:45, 4:50, somewhere around there. It's just before we have a pressurized water source established. We've run out of all the available water on scene. We've exhausted the Litchfield tanker, and we're just waiting for the hydrant to be tagged.
Pretty much the strategy. The next slide, what you're going to see is I'm going to order the Windham engine to place. You can still see over the garage, it's still standing a little bit. The main house is absolutely fully involved in fire, but the only hope that I had is that the victim went back towards the bedroom area. So I ordered the Windham engine to come in and place a ladder. We have a process we call vent, enter, and search, where you pretty much smash the glass, you'll look in with a thermal imaging camera, and that's the next sequence that happened, because going inside the house was untenable because the roof was collapsing, but we thought maybe, you know, that would be a quick, you know, just a quick down and dirty vent, enter, and search look in the, if we saw somebody, we could actually make a rescue.
Question about the hydrant. When an engine arrives at the hydrant, how long does it take to pressurize the hose and distribute the water?
If an engine to hook up to a hydrant and get a supply, probably within minutes. The only thing you're looking at here is, with a hydrant being so far away, 890 feet.
So how long does it take to lay 890 feet with the hose and pressurize and go?
It's to guesstimate it, it's probably going to take 10 minutes.
Thank you.
This picture doesn't look very good on the screen, but on this side, the windows to the garage, the above the garage doors, their windows are still intact on this picture. There'll be a following picture farther down.
So at this point, we are looking at an arrival of 4:28, and at 4:40, they were already in the defensive.
Yes, yeah, because as my 360 revealed that the roof was starting to collapse, so it was definitely unsafe. But To be honest with you, too, as far as victim, you know, salvageability, even with less amount of that fire, I mean, it's a misconception that maybe the public has sometimes that, you know, people die in a fire, they die from the products and combustion. If you had a means of measure the amount of carbon monoxide and hydrogen cyanide before even that amount of fire, it would be astronomical. We're, you know, not survivable without respiratory protection. Two things happened there. The communication specialist guided the Hudson engine right into the scene. One, because he has maps up in front of him, but two, his familiarity with the town and knowing, you know, basically, you know, he was able to guide him right in, knew exactly, you know, where the fire was. So he, it was, that was a huge help that night too. Just the communication specialist's familiarity with the town.
So Jim, based on the timeline, it sort of begs the question of if we were staffed with four people on each engine, if there were four on the ladder at the same time, you had a full complement of two ambulances full, shift commander, that's 22 people. Would the result have been any different?
I would say there's always a possibility, but because of what we had upon arrival that night, I don't think it would have been. And the only thing it, you could see the difference of how far, pretty much what we did, and we're going to get into it. We had to break crew integrity that night. We had to use, you know, with a two-man engine company, our biggest disadvantage, John, was coming in. One person can't run a 2.5-inch line. There's no way. So with a 2-inch, plus you had the four occupants were also in the driveway. The four occupants, member of the family, they needed medical attention. So we were incredibly challenged that night with, you know, what was going on. With additional manpower, if you take not this fire, but another fire with even much less involvement, 35% involvement, what you're just saying, that fire wouldn't stand a chance, especially for a rescue, especially for to locate, confine the fire, and do search and rescue. It would be a different story. But with this particular fire with that much involvement, the answer is no, it wouldn't have mattered.
You had indicated earlier that a fire doubles every 90 seconds.
Yes.
So, just by my calculations, that means about 8.5-9 minutes, you'd be totally engulfed. Would you agree with that?
I would agree with that, but it's all going to depend on the compartmentation, the construction, how the fire is going to spread. So if we took ideal conditions, right? Ideal conditions being, you know, doing in a laboratory test, and that's what NFPA does. And they look and they say, okay, they measure a fire, and then they measure, they'll do a mock-up of a house, and they'll use regular furnishing, and so, and then they'll say that fire will double in size 90 seconds if it's not put out. Now, that's going to depend on what type of fuel is burning. So there are a little bit of different variables that are going to be there.
But it looks like in this case, it was pretty much engulfed in about 8 or 9 minutes.
Uh-huh. Pretty much, yeah, especially with the amount of fire that was upon arrival.
Okay, and I think from your recitation, you guys got there at about 4:28, and you got the call at 4:20, about 8 minutes later.
Right. I think we were dispatched at 4:21.
Okay. Yeah, but the call came in at best it was 4:20. Yeah. And just so you can give us some kind of sense, I think you said your tankers had 3,000 gallons or something like that, would you?
No, we arrived on scene, sir, with 3,000 gallons. So each Class A pumper that we have, each engine company, carries 1,000 gallons of water. So when we arrived on scene, you know, the first two, an engine carries, so that the first two engines that arrived on scene were carrying each 1,000 gallons. And then eventually engine one arriving on scene brought us another 1,000, and then the Windham engine with another 1,000.
And how long, using your hoses, does it take to discharge 1,000 gallons?
Again, it all depends what you're using. For this particular night, the two hose lines that were chosen by the company office were 1¾-inch line, which is 150 gallons a minute, and then it was backed right up with a 2½-inch line, which is 250 gallons a minute. The theory behind that is to have the maneuverability of the 1¾-inch line and then to have the knockdown power. When you look at a fire like this, the one thing, no matter how good that, you know, I have 22 years, Captain Caldwell has more than I have. Sometimes you think you're good, but you can't change the laws of physics. You know, if you have X amount of BTUs, you need X amount of GPMs. I don't care how good you are. If you don't have the GPMs, it's a losing battle.
I know that we don't have a tanker in Londonderry. How many gallons does the Litchfield tanker bring?
I believe it was 2,500.
Yeah, the way we look at our run cards is we try to bring at least 5,000 to 6,000 gallons to each alarm with mutual aid tankers. So usually it's two tankers of varying either 2,500 or a 3,000 gallon tanker. Windham is a 3,000. Litchfield is 2,500. Hudson just bought a new one. It's a 2,500 gallon tanker.
Yeah, Auburn is a 2,500.
Does our ladder truck hold water?
300 gallons.
That's
it. It's really not a. It's really not made for that purpose.
It's made. It has enough water to fill the waterway at an incident, so it can fill its own pipe, and then there's no delay when it gets to the fire.
Is part of the science of that is that's to get you temporarily fighting the fire until you can hook up, and it might take 4 or 5 minutes to hook up because that's all the water, you know. In 4 or 5 minutes, your tank is gone.
No, not especially with hand lines. You know, you figure your average flow, if you're flowing, you know, 250 gallons a minute, you know, so you're looking at, you know, 4 minutes, you know, for 1,000 gallons of water. And then, you know, if you have a 3,000 gallon tanker with the complement of a first alarm assignment, I mean, if we had a 3,000 gallon tanker, you know, we could have 6,000 gallons of water on scene. That would be the difference. I don't know if that answers your question.
Yeah, maybe I just misunderstood or don't understand, but you said something about, I think, even when you hooked up to the hydrant, it had a pressurize. Is that, when you hook up to a hydrant, it's not immediate? Is there some delay?
Yeah, there is. It all depends how far the hydrant is from the fire. You know, each pumper carries 1,000 feet of 5-inch hose. So, you know, most, like, if we looked in the cities, or even if we looked up further up that street, if you, you know, took a ride up into Derry, on our forest goes to Hope Hill Road, you're going to see a hydrant every 500 feet. So every 500 feet. So in a situation when a hydrant district, the second due piece of apparatus or third due piece of apparatus, depending on what the situation may be, will lay in from the hydrant. But that's, you know, in the city of Manchester or even other towns, 500 feet, 300 feet, that's usually a norm. That's usually what we see.
And for clarification purposes, can you just tell us the 2,500-gallon tanker? What's that equivalent to? Is that like a pool water truck, or is it something different from that?
Your average, like above-ground swimming pool, is 10,000 gallons. You know, in-ground's 20,000. So you're nowhere near.
So it's just a small boxy water.
It's a tandem axle truck. You're at the limit of what we can pretty much haul over the road is 3,000 gallons on a, unless you're going to a tractor trailer. You know, a tractor trailer is going to haul up to 8,000 or 9,000 gallons of water.
Those pool trucks carry like 5,000 to 6,000.
Yeah, you see the pool water tractor trailers, they're in the 6,000 to 8,000 gallons, depending on how many axles and horsepower.
Okay. Thanks, Doug.
That's one more question on the when you arrived at 428, you said you know, give or take 80% involved the fire. So that would mean that you also said something about the amount of carbon monoxide there as well. That would be inhabitable.
Yes, it would. For anybody who is an unprotected person in that type of scenario, absolutely. It's carbon monoxide, hydrogen cyanide. all the products of combustion that they're burning. I mean, it's really, it's incredible. I mean, if you watch the movie Backdraft, it's very entertaining, but there's no way. I mean, with the black acrylic smoke is really what's before the fire even progresses is where we see the deaths in houses.
Well, one thing I can share is, I think it was probably 2 or 3 years ago, you guys did that controlled burn. My wife had that home there that you guys took
exactly
out.
Yep.
And I remember, and this is just my little 2 cents, I remember when I was standing out there watching, I remember a couple times I just had the smoke blow my way, and I was shocked at how it took your breath away. And I can just imagine how it would have been in a controlled, in a room like that. I couldn't even imagine it. So I wanted to say that.
Well, you talk about products of combustion, they changed over the years. 50 years ago, it was wood. You know, we have plastics and, you know, everything else involved, and it's just more, you know.
More synthetics.
So I guess a follow-up to that question, hate to ask, but how much of a house needs to be involved before you really start worrying about that? I mean, I know it could be one room, and the person could be in that room, and then it wouldn't matter, I guess, but, I mean, just to throw it out, 50% of the house be involved, how much of that other 50% would be any usable air?
Well, usually in a wood frame structure, I mean, you know, we've had fires, you know, in Londonderry where we have, you know, 35-40% involvement. You know, we arrive, we get early notification. You know, we're in a hydrant district, we have the water, we can go in, you know, we get a quick knockdown. I mean, a good example to that is, in contrast to this fire, was a couple of years ago, we did a trench rescue class, and we were right at the town yard, and we had extra people with us, you know, because of the trench rescue class, and right up the street, I think it was Hickory Hill, I forget the street.
Fairway Drive.
We pulled in, all of a sudden we get a call for, just like this, reported structure fire. We basically kept a small fire, small upon arrival, two-story wood frame house, a little similar, fire showing out from the bedroom window. It was a luxury that I haven't had. Chief McCaffrey pulled in. I had command. Basically, I had a first line going in the door to attack the fire as that was happening simultaneously. Hookups were happening from engine to engine. Ladders would be in place. Search and rescue was in progress. You know, basically, I had 12 guys. I had 12 guys that day, and it made a ton of difference. We were able to keep a small fire small.
And that was a 20-30% fire?
Yeah, that was pretty much in the bedroom extending out. So you're looking about probably about 20-25%.
Even in this fire, the bedroom over the garage was tenable for a considerable amount of time while they dropped a cell phone out the window. Made attempts to find a way out, and even the occupant themselves was able to get out without too much difficulty because their door was closed to the opposite side of the house. So as soon as they opened the door, then it became untenable for them, and he retreated. So in retrospect, depending on how much is involved in the house, there are still areas in the household that are protected.
I believe, Councilor Green, one of your questions was, at what percentage of a fire is somebody overcome? Am I correct?
That's right.
Yep. You can have a pot on the stove, depending on what is interacting with that. I mean, if it's a piece of plastic, you could be in the living room and be overcome by that smoke. It doesn't have to be a percentage involvement to count, but what is burning and what the products of combustion and how it's affecting the body.
Right, and I guess the other part of it, which was already answered, would be visually, to measure that visually. I mean, forget about what. That's a good point that you made. Thank you for that. But I guess visually, when you don't know what substances you have burning, what would be kind of a thought process of a house being 80% involved on arrival? That's what you answered. Thank
right.
you.
Any other thing with the percentage gives us the probability of collapse. That's one thing we're always looking at. The more percentage of volume of fire, the more the structural components are going to be weakened by fire and with more potential of collapse.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, maybe what we can do is something we did with the police, is once we complete all this and everything, have them come in another time, maybe do about 20-25 minutes on general fire safety so that gets captured, goes out to the public.
Great idea. Thanks, John.
Sure. Before we go any further, I had a question really quick. Fire alarms, been a lot of questions about that. you said this house had fire alarms, right?
It's actually, Brian, if you'd like to comment on it.
The house was required to have fire alarms. Talking with the homeowners and the first due arriving companies, and with the amount of bedroom that was left over the garage, there was no notification noticed by anybody. The people in the residence don't remember hearing the smoke alarms. Our first due engine company never heard the smoke alarms, and there were none audible when I know Iris got on scene, and the bedroom over the garage had heavy black smoke coming out, but no fire, but there was no audible alarms.
So when you have it at the beginning, there were alarms. It was just like first calls, audible. There was nothing tied into the fire department, right?
Correct.
Okay.
So I think, Doug, you were on command on the Tyler fire?
Tyler fire was mine, yep.
Right. So that was a fire that you got there, and it was about 20 to 30% involved, and you guys knocked it down at the kitchen, if I remember, or the family room.
That was a very similar building and construction, wood frame, single family, two-story. Had a bump-out garage, nothing over, no bedroom over the garage. The first report was for a garage fire. Our arrival, the garage was falling in. There was a breezeway type of one-and-a-half story between that and the house. There was no rescue to be done at that point. We were able to take our personnel at that point and directly engage them in firefighting.
And no hydrants, right?
No hydrants. That case, the garage was falling when we got there. The breezeway had considerable damage. The main house was still standing when we left. You know, I had smoke and fire damage, but, you know, still the same idea. It's, I think they ended up, the insurance company tore it down, but the house was, I mean,
you were able to stop the fire, though.
Absolutely.
With 3,000 gallons of water.
Yeah, in that case, I mean, you kind of, you've heard some of the audio calls, you get the indication, like Captain Rogers said, when he came downstairs, a lot of times we'll turn to the dispatcher and say, what are your indications? They know whether they've got multiple calls or what people are saying. You know, they smell smoke or they see smoke or they know there's fire. So in that case, as I pulled out of Central Station responding, I requested the working fire then. And it's very similar to timing in Captain Rogers' incident. If we can get that water on the road, if it's a small fire, you know, in this case, Tyler Drive, we wrote the garage off. There's nothing to save. There was cars in the garage. We're writing them off. We're trying to save the main house. So we deployed hose lines between the garage and the main house to stop that fire. But yes, we did not lose water. I believe, if my memory serves me right, three or four mutual aid tankers from all the neighboring communities responded. I mean, truck companies from the city of Manchester came down to give us a hand because we left our ladder truck in the station because we couldn't staff it. You can look at similar fires like Kestry Drive. That was about a year before. Same thing, no rescue to be performed. Fire started.
Colonial.
Colonial was a fire upon arrival that started outside, different weather conditions. All the windows of the house were open. So the fire that started outside was on the composite decking, which is, it's plastics, you know, it's gasoline. Very rapid fire, entered the first floor windows because it was a farmer porch, and it was through the house upon our arrival. That was 100% involvement. Like, you know, like Jim says, you can't overcome that GPM flow, the damage is done.
Yeah, that was probably more similar to what this was, the Hemlock Street fire, you know, if you looked at it.
This girl escaped out back. That's half a dozen houses away from me. The Tyler fire is behind me.
Yeah, I remember the Colonial fire that day. I was, my daughter had asked me to go pick up her friend who lived two houses over, and I heard all the commotion, and then the next thing you know, her friend came screaming out of the house, saying that the house, you know, the long story short, I remember calling up 911 then. And
I mean, there's a lot of fires we can compare. What it comes down to is, with our limited manpower and resources, if it's a small fire, we can usually stop it. You get to a point where it's, you know, 80% involved, it's beyond the curve.
What I understand you're saying, and please tell me if I'm not understanding you correctly. What I hear you saying is, and including this fire, every fire is different.
Yes, every fire is different.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
You had your hand up?
Oh, one question I had. I imagine you had no idea whether people might be still inside, what part of the house.
Well, the only thing with my conversation with Mr. Galing was, you know, was everybody out of the house, and what was the last known? So he told me where his daughter was, and he told me where his wife, you know, where she went. And that's why I ordered what I ordered for that vent entrance search, hoping that, you know, being the conditions that they were, that she would have tried to retreat and go back towards. From what we understand from piecing it together, talking to Brian, talking to the State Fire Marshal's office, when the family exited the bulkhead, they came out around to the front of the house. Son banged on the house, and that got the father's attention. Immediately, when the father opened the window and the mother heard that their house was on fire, she immediately, instinctively went open that door, went down that hallway towards her. Now, it was only a matter of seconds that the father and son were having a conversation and the window was open, but the key was by opening that door, that lit the products of combustion. I believe from what I understand, Mr. Galing did try to go down that hallway, but in a matter of seconds, that environment changed dramatically. And I believe he was dropped to his knees, went back to the window, tried to get a breath and go back, and there was no way. So once that door was open, so that's why that command to do vent enter and search in that area was a hopeful task.
But if you don't really have an idea of where they are, where somebody might be,
no,
trapped, you've got to kind of divide your forces, don't you?
Yeah, and what we do is we divide it up to fire attack, search and rescue, ventilation. In the search and rescue crew, they have thermal imaging cameras, so they're going to go in. You know, with that particular fire, without being as involved as it was, the tactic would be the first hose line would go up the front stairs, hold the stairs, and we would confine the fire, not really worrying about extinguishing the fire. We want to confine the fire to allow search and rescue to do what they have to do, and at the same time providing ventilation, which is going to open it up, release the products of combustion, allowing that search to go much more rapidly.
Thank you.
This was at 4:45. Again, the incident commander is just confirming the message with fire alarm for the dairy engine.
Command, fire alarm. Incident command. My next new engine company, a dairy engine company. Please confirm the message. Have them weigh in from the hydrant to the scene. We pass on to Debbie. We'll make sure they've got it.
You have to realize is that we operate on two different frequencies, and you'll hear our fire alarm operator talking to the dairy fire alarm operator. They talk back and forth on the same frequencies all the time, and the responding units, until they usually hit the town line or have a good sense of where they're going, they'll stay on their own frequency. So if we're going to the community of dairy to provide assistance, until we get halfway across Pillsbury Road, will we go to the dairy channel? You know, we're fortunate enough that we can listen to them, we get closer, we'll talk to them and provide. So our dispatcher is trying to communicate directly with the dairy engine what is not on our frequency right now. So he'll call, they don't answer, he'll jump over to their channel or get on the phone, and sometimes it takes a few seconds. So.
And I was just trying to confirm that upon arrival on their way in, they were going to lay into the fire and give us a water source. We were hoping with, you know, 4,000 gallons of water, that would have roughly gave us 9 minutes of firefighting capability. And then, you know, with a response time of 9 or 10 minutes, we would have a pressurized water source. That was the strategy for that night.
Tanker on team.
The whole purpose of that is for accountability. I have to account for everybody on what we call the fire ground. So I have to write down and have an accountability board, whether they're a mutual aid company, whether they're Londonderry. I know where everybody is at any time. In case of the collapse of the building or whatever, I know exactly. I have accountability of the fire scene. Right here, what you're going to see is how long it took. I think, Councilor Green, you were asking, like, engine two, 7 minutes to respond. Engines three, truck one, car two, we were kind of all behind each other coming out of Central Station. It took us 9 minutes. And then engine one from station one took a 12-minute response time. These are the mutual aid companies. These are time of arrival, arrival time, and time lapsed. Time lapse is from the beginning of the call. So you can just see, looking at mutual aid, you know, basically use the mutual aid, you're going to have to call early to get mutual aid to come in, depending on geographically where they're coming from. A couple of no-cost changes that we've already made since this fire is changing some of the run cards to always get the closest piece. You know, it's great that, you know, towns, you know, how they're situated geographically, we're trying to, you know, get the closest piece right away, just to cut down that curve time that we talked about earlier.
Actually, I had a quick question on that.
Sure.
On the earlier slide, it looked like some of the dairy stations were closer traffic-wise, but like one of them was 11, I think it was, and one of our stations was 11, maybe equal to it. How come it was such a significantly large difference in time from when Londonderry arrived versus when Derry arrived?
Yeah, Derry sent different pieces from different stations. So if you go back to that right there, yeah. Actually their central station, I believe, is the closest. That's where the medic, the two medics came out of coming. Their engine three came from English Range Road. The truck came, that their aerial truck came from Warner Hill Road. So I guess it's, you know, more geographically where they were coming from.
The engine that was requested to lay into the fire was the engine that was assigned from Derry Station 3, so English Range Road, so the 15-minute travel time.
Water supply. You can just see Bruce is going to play, and then I'll just run down quick on water supply.
This audio clip's a little difficult. Everybody's on the talk around channel, our fire ground channel, so fire alarm doesn't hear it. This is just what the antenna occasionally picked up, but you'll get the gist of the messages.
Pretty much what we're hoping for here is get that supply line pressurized and just get the truck in operation. That was the lieutenant reporting back to me that the vent entrance search was it was not successful. So back with the water supply, the issues, you know, mutual aid engine assigned to the hydrant, lack of available water on scene because of the area, lack of personnel on scene to complete the task. This is a key component right here. If engine two was a three-man company instead of a two-man company, what we probably could have did was probably have engine one, even though the hydrant is in Derry, We would have probably had engine one coming from station one go into Derry, lay in from that hydrant, and lay into the scene. But because of four occupants being in a driveway, two occupants trapped, engine two being by themselves, two persons, there was really, we had to change our strategy on that. That was huge right there. The hydrant itself was a dead-end hydrant, so it had low pressure. The hydrant was located in Derry. The other disadvantage of that, too, is we would know because, like, you know, in Londonderry, Penichuk or Manchester Waterworks, if there's a hydrant out of service, they're going to call our fire alarm. So we know every day we get an update if any hydrant is out of service, so we can make alternative plans. Even if it is a hydrant district, we could automatically call for tankers early. We would know that. This information, they would only tell Derry. They wouldn't tell us, you know. They wouldn't, because it's in the town of Derry and not Londonderry. Pretty much this slide kind of wraps it up right here.
Command a fire alarm. Dancing, command. Fire alarm under control was probably about 25 minutes ago. Presently, crews are picking up supply lines and taking up. And also, state fire marshal on scene.
Under control about 25 minutes ago. Crews are picking up, and the fire marshal's on. That's it. Okay. If you want to go back.
Yeah.
Staffing. Staffing with the required staffing for this type of fire, if we looked at NFPA 1710, if we looked at Chief McCaffrey's staffing report that he gave a while back, and pretty much this is what you would see on the fire ground. You'd see it has to be a dedicated incident commander, attack lines where firefighters are going inside the building with, you know, an attack line, a backup line, search and rescue team, ventilation team, sustainable water source. And really, when we add up on the fire ground, on operating, we're talking 15 personnel to cover all the functions. And to come close to that standard, you know, 8 minutes, 90% of the time is what they're really striving for to get. How do we match up? How does the Londonderry Fire Department match up with National Fire Protection 1710? Engine 1 comes the closest when there is 10 people on duty. Lately, we're running at 9. We're running at 9 people. We have a couple of vacancies, so we're running at 9. It's the only one that comes closest. Engine 2 is a 2-man company, 50%. As we said earlier, at Central Station, we cleared that up. That the engine 3, truck 1, rescue are cross-manned. Really, so when we add this all up and we look at it, we meet that standard by 56.2%. One of the staffing issues that we have is a 2-man engine company. Nowhere does the NFPA, any third-party source, or around the country, do they recognize a 2-man engine company?
Excellent.
So looking at the internal view, what were our strengths that night? We requested additional resources early. The working fire, a tanker, an additional engine, before units even got on scene. So before we even got on scene, as we got updated information from our telecommunicators, we were putting wheels on the road. Apparatus placement, guys did a great job that night. Attack piece, they placed the apparatus where it was supposed to be. The aerial was placed where it was supposed to be. The company offices made great decisions with the hose line, looking to hopefully get hose lines in the building and to initiate a rescue command structure. Once chief officers got there, I plugged in the whole incident command system to make sure we were safe and effective, doing the best job. Londonderry firefighters training. I can't say more about their training. These guys know their job in and out. They know how to fight fires, do rescue work. They're all hazard approach fire department, no matter what the emergency is. The equipment is subpar to none. Captain Caldwell does a great job with our equipment, our apparatus. We have the best. The only thing we lack is people. That's our downfall. On-duty staffing. That night, we were at 10. We had a captain and 9 firefighters. We had to break crew integrity. Crew integrity is something where we use a buddy system. We look out for one another. We follow the federal laws. We try to follow OSHA 1910-134. It's respiratory protection standard, two in and two out. We have crew integrity. We couldn't do it that night. We fell short. Fire ground frequencies, because of the activity that was going on, we're working on that. We actually have a training program in place right now. We're using our state radios and using Bank H. We're making more availability, and we're going to test that out at the airport drill coming up. A tanker. Think of any of these type of emergencies. Think of it as this. It's a job. It's a job that comes in. For me to do the job, I need the right tools. So I got to put the right tools in my toolbox. So one of the tools that night would have been a tanker, to have one. The only thing is, when the toolbox is that heavy, I need the staff to get the toolbox there. That was a disadvantage where we fell short. Training with mutual aid companies, that's something that we've always done. But what we've done lately is even increase that in training with our closer mutual aid companies. We just did a series of four trainings with Manchester for the whole north end of town in the commercial area with them. We've updated our run cards just recently to make sure we're getting the closest apparatus. We've increased tankers so that if we have a fire today in a non-hydrant district, that a mutually closest tanker is wheels on the road just as we're getting on the road to cut down that curb that we talked about, the curb of having the BTU GPM curve. Municipal water system. You know, one thing we forget, we're a large town with 42 square miles. We're only protected by 40-45% of a municipal system. That's a huge disadvantage for us.
Excellent.
That just gives you a kind of a snapshot of, you know, what the chief was talking about, that room over the garage. And again, the fire involvement there all the way through. Really, the collapse has already happened in the back of the building at this point. And once the aerial did go in operation, it took a matter of probably 15 minutes. The fire was completely knocked down. Once there was a pressurized water source, and the aerial can flow up to 2,000 GPM, 2,000 gallons a minute. It's no match for that fire once it can go into operation. Yeah, sometimes at a fire like this, it's a little challenging because you are running two frequencies, two radios at the same time, writing everything down, accountability, just making sure as an incident commander that, one, you're effective as you can be, but you're also as safe as you can be at the same time. It's kind of like just keeping track of things. That's pretty much a mobile office is what that is. You know, trying to on the fly, right up and down, and try to keep everything as organized as possible. Okay, and that's leading into the next day.
Hi, everyone.
Yep. Thanks, Vinny. All right. So we have many questions, I'm sure. I know I do. How do we want to do this, Council?
I don't know. There's two glaring questions. Tanker, personnel. I don't know how you want to conduct this.
Can I make a suggestion? Just on that, if we started, I think the timeline we went through pretty well, you know, with going through the timeline of events, unless there's a question on the timeline. But if you wanted, we could just go where it says observations, issues, and recommendation. And then if any member of the council had a question, you know, we could just stop at each one and answer any question that you had, whichever way you prefer.
I just have a
preliminary question. With regard to the NFPA standards for staffing, you had a display up there, which I think was a suggestion that, or recommendation for 15, you needed 15 firefighters on scene.
That's to do every function that you need to do on the fire department. You need 15 within the first 8 minutes to do all of those functions.
Now, am I right that the NFPA standards say that you can count mutual aid towards that?
As long as they can arrive in that appropriate amount of time, that's okay. Correct.
Do you have, according to, well, it's about, I guess, 9 minutes. No, excuse me, it's not. It's 20 minutes. Well, I'm sorry. Okay.
No, we all arrive somewhere around the 12-minute mark.
Okay. And what about mutual aid? When did the first of them arrive?
The first of them arrived probably at the
20 minutes?
Mark.
I think it was 19 minutes with them.
Yeah. 21 minutes, so, yep.
Okay.
There's a lot of standards that NFPA comes out with. They look at there is fire ground operation 1710, our operations as a professional organized fire department and how we place them and how they're effective. They also look at just per capita. You know, they say you should have X amount, you know, on duty for your stat, you know, your community. They also look at it for apparatus response. We have apparatus now that we don't staff. You know, it's just we can only spread our people so thin. But if you look at it, they recommend X per unit, not just. So whichever way you look at it, if you look at it for 1710, you look at it for per capita, or you look at it per unit, you're still coming back to the same number. So.
And that's 15?
15, 16, yes.
And right now you've got 10.
That's correct.
Today we have 9.
Today we have 9.
Now, why is that?
Yeah.
Money?
Money.
There's 4 platoons, or battalions. We call them battalions. Each one has X amount of people assigned to them. So somebody retired on my day. So I'm running at 9 because we can't afford to fill that slot. Captain Rogers' battalion runs at 10. The other 2 battalions are also running at 9.
Unless somebody calls out sick. So tomorrow when I come into work, if nobody calls out sick or takes a vacation day, I'll have myself and 9 firefighters. So that what that gives you, sir, for protection is at the north end of town, you'll have a lieutenant and 2 firefighters. When an engine company up there, out of central, you have myself, a lieutenant, 2 paramedics, and a firefighter. And down the south end, you'll have a lieutenant and a firefighter. That's pretty much what it divides the town up.
But if you're at 10 now and you need 15, that's a 50% increase. Would you do that by adding additional, just all additional firemen, or would you do it through a combination of firemen and OT?
You can do it however you wish, depending on how much you want to spend on personnel. You can do it all and have 15 every day.
Okay. So how many line firefighters do you have right now?
9 firefighters and 1 captain.
The department, because we're talking a 50% increase.
40.
So you'd add 20.
That's correct.
Okay.
What's the status of the SAFER grant?
Declined.
I mean, I hear stories.
Unfunded.
Right. And given what's going on in Washington, we count denied on zero. Yeah.
No, we were not denied. We were at the bottom of the pile when they ran out of money.
So we were eligible for the grant, but there was no money.
That's correct. More people were
fun?
Eligible than more people had a higher need than we did.
And that would have added 4.
That would have added right. 4. That's correct.
We actually made it to the last round. We made it all the way to the last round. There is, and I shouldn't even say this, is that there's a small glimmer of hope out there that there's a lot of communities that didn't take the SAFER grant for one reason or another. So last I heard, there was a $8.5 million that has to be issued out. We would probably be one of the towns that they would, I mean, it could be other towns that have laid off people off, but where we made it so high, you know, almost to the last round, there's a slight possibility that we would have a chance at that.
And what would 4 do to change your 4 effectiveness?
Would give us the another effective piece. Would not mean we wouldn't have we'd have 3-man engine companies.
It's given on one shift, right?
You're adding 1 person to each battalion. So you know, if we didn't have a crisis where we're dropping down due to long-term illnesses or you know sickness or that type of thing or retirements, It would allow us to have three firefighters or lieutenant and two firefighters at the north end station and the same at the south end station. You're going to have 2 3-man companies.
Right, exactly. So if we were lucky enough to get that SAFER grant, we probably would have staffed engine 2, station 2 would be a 3-man company. Only because, you know, it just makes the most sense to have them as a 3-man company. But in return, if everybody else is busy, if a medical call arose, they could take that ambulance out also. They wouldn't need the engine to go with them.
Well, let me ask it a different way, because you said you have basically a rule that if you have two guys on a truck, you're not sending them into a fire.
By federal law?
Right.
NFPA 1500 says this. NFPA 1500 says, unless you have two in and two out, you are not supposed to make an attempt into the building until you have on the fire. There is an exception. If I went to your house, sir, and I knew you were in there, I can make that exception.
Okay.
And I would make that exception.
But other than that, effectively, and don't take this as derogatory, but other than that, if you're following the rules, these guys get there and they can fight. I imagine, do something from the outside, but they can't enter the building because it's on fire. If you've got somebody that says, I'm not breaking the rule here.
Okay. But if you had
a third person, you've made that truck effectively or engine able to go inside the building. Would that be fair to say? Because then you've got three people on that truck.
You would still, to follow the standard to the federal law, the intent, you would have to wait till one more person got there and then go in. The reason with the two-man engine company is a term we call dead manning the pump. So let's say engine 2 and out in the south end right now responds to a fire in central district. It's a little ways away, such as this one. There was a little bit of delay between them. Mm-hmm. So they would actually, if they had that known life hazard in that house, they would actually dead man that pump. And they would go inside that house by themselves without any backup outside. That really around the country right now is unheard of because it's a mechanical device. You really need it. And that's why that night, we took extraordinary chances because we thought we had a rescue. It wasn't the fire that Captain Caldwell talked about on Tyler Drive, because we broke crews and we did extraordinary things to maybe make a rescue that night. We broke crew until we had one guy running two pieces of fire apparatus. Okay. So basically, he shuffled back and forth.
So, because maybe I'm just not getting it, but if you got four guys, that would, as you said, give you one more per, what you call a battalion?
Yes.
Oh, okay. And that's helpful, but you would need four guys to effectively make that responding engine be able to go into the building. If you're
correct. You hire four individuals, they get assigned one per each battalion. That one firefighter gets assigned to a 2-man company, which now makes it 3. When they arrive on scene of a building fire, you know, like Captain Rogers saying, if there's a rescue to be made, they can pretty much do what they need to do. But if not, the law states that they wait until there's two other responders to back them up. Because basically, we just found out we were killing too many firefighters. We're putting them at risk too much. So they want us to take a step back, look at a risk-based analysis, risk a lot to save a lot, risk a little to save a little, is what it comes down to. But you are correct. If they have 3 men on a fire pumper and they respond, they will need an additional firefighter to act.
And the mutual aid arrived about 10 or 12 minutes after your guys arrived.
Yes.
Okay. And there was no, that's your initial response, and no other Londonderry guys got there between the first 8 minutes in the mutual aid?
All of ours were there before mutual aid arrived.
Okay.
Yeah, in 8 minutes.
And we were very fortunate that night that the communities that assisted us, the mutual aid partners of Hudson, Litchfield, Windham, and Derry, were all in quarters and available. The ambulances weren't out, you know, their trucks weren't being used somewhere else. You know, you always count on your neighbors, and sometimes their snowblowers broke too, so.
The only reason we know that is in our command car, we monitor all those other frequencies. We have a radio on scan. So that particular night, I knew there was nothing else going on my 8-minute ride to Hemlock Street. So, sir, there's one thing I just wanted. You make a good point. But the one thing we keep talking about, fire, the two-in and two-out rule is the same thing in general industry. If we go up for a hazardous materials release at Stonyfield Yogurt, That's a what they call an IDLH environment, immediately dangerous to life and health. That's what a structure fire is. So whether it's a structure fire, whether it's a hazmat, confined space rescue, our partners in industry, Stonyfield Yogurt, Granite Ridge, you name it up there, they do confined space, Kluber Lubrication, it's the same thing. So we face the same issue on almost every emergency that we go to.
Mr. Chairman, I have a question on NFPA 1710. How many communities around our area actually meet the requirements?
I believe that the who meets the requirement is the city of Nashua. City of Nashua meets the 1710. I don't know if Derry does or not.
Derry does if they're fully staffed.
If they're fully staffed. Derry does. City of Manchester, they could provide that. Derry, Manchester, Nashua. Not that much. That's pretty much it that surrounds us.
And the other question I had, when I moved here about 16 years ago, there were volunteer firefighters. And I know that it's a completely different time. But where we have call firefighters, what it would be the possibility, and I'm going to ask a stupid question because I just don't know.
It's not a
the possibility of actually having some kind of a creation of that again, kind of going back to it, because, you know, right now we're in, it's obvious we need more people. But, at the same time, we need to try to keep our taxes down, but you can't put a price on life.
Right. No, we actually do, sir. We actually do have call firefighters.
I understand that, but I guess my question is, why wouldn't they be staffing it like the volunteer? I mean, the volunteer firefighters used to be right across from Crossroads. I remember that used to be a volunteer firefighter. I mean,
well, yeah. The only thing is, things have unfortunately, it's really changed. I mean, if you go back, I mean, I've been on it for 22 years, and you know, Doug can tell you, you know, when he was on back then, a lot of people worked in the town. You know, they worked, they lived in town, and they were able to be released by their employers. I mean, that's the way it used to be. Unfortunately, what we did over the years was we hired all our call firefighters. You know, we had a lot of young kids that, you know, went to the tech program or whatever, and they were call firefighters. We hired them. We still have 10, I believe it's 10 active call firefighters on the roster. $20,000 was put back in the budget, you know, a town meeting, you know, to keep them going. And so we do have 10 as it is right now. We try to utilize them. I believe they have training.
Is it once a month?
Once a month, they still have training.
So in this particular situation, the call firefighters, were there any on duty that night, or anybody that's on call? Or
the call firefighters are not on duty. They respond through the pager system. They have radio pagers. When the initial call goes out, is the on-duty staffing. When you get to that pinch point, whether it's we activate the system or there's automatics like the work and fire, their radio pages will go off. It'll alert them, you know, of the incident, the location, and they'll respond if they can. Sometimes they'll go to the station if it's closer, or they'll go to the incident. But the way the fire service has changed, when I'm not going to say how long ago I started, but I was on an engine by myself at the north end of town. My sole responsibility was to get that engine to the scene. And when you got there, these call firefighters would join us, and you would assemble, and then you would fight the fire. Well, our role has changed. Our responsibilities have changed. We didn't have technical rescue. We didn't have confined space. We didn't have a hazmat. We didn't have plastics on all these houses. You know, the breathing apparatus at the time, you wove the belts together, you know. The world has changed. And then with that, has a training.
So in compliment to the question that I just asked, how many communities around the New Hampshire area actually now have volunteer firefighter or partial volunteer?
There's quite a few what they call combination departments. I mean, if you look at, like, you know, smaller towns, smaller geographically, such as, you know, maybe Hampstead, even Windham, being a full-time fire department, complements with call. But the problem we're running into, and everybody's running into, and they're having to put more people on, is because, unfortunately, the standards nowadays, they don't look at whether you're a call firefighter or full-time. You have to have the same standard. It, just for us to be EMTs or paramedics, I mean, to keep up those certificates, you know, I mean, it requires a lot of time and dedication, so it's really tough. I mean, times have changed so much. Just as Captain Cardwell spoke, when you look at the Londonderry Fire Department, the full-time firefighters training, I mean, for a call firefighter to do that, unless they were, you know, self-employed and really had the means, they would be extremely challenged to probably keep up certifications.
Unless we paid for it, right?
It doesn't matter. I mean, you can pay for it isn't really the underlying cause. It's the time and if they're available.
Yeah.
So we hold call firefighter training, you know, sometimes on the weekends, mostly it's weeknights, 7 o'clock on a Wednesday. And I can guarantee you we're not going to get all 10 there because they're not all available. And it's the same thing if there's a call. We can invest a lot of time and money into training them, equipping them, but if they don't show up.
I'm just trying to think out of the box. We got a problem. We got to try to solve it. And so all the questions, you know, these could be relevant. So
did you guys say you have apparatus that is unmanned?
Absolutely.
And I don't mean like surplus. You mean like front of the line stuff and you just don't have people?
Right now, if you take the station, the number we have, there are four firefighters and a lieutenant, three firefighters and a captain at Central Station. And there are how many pieces of apparatus, Doug? Five? All right, so that would be one guy per truck if you wanted to do it, but we send two guys on the ambulance, and we leave two back, and they either take the backup ambulance on the next call, the truck on an alarm like this, or the engine on an alarm like this. That night, we deadheaded both ambulances to take the engine and the truck to the fire. That's what we do. So we were left, and we had a mutual aid ambulance come on that alarm. So to cover the medical end of it. So we left the rescue back with nobody on it, and the two ambulances had nobody on it.
We try to complete the mission that's in front of us at the time. Just before this meeting, we had a motor vehicle accident on a highway. Not that you guys haven't seen that. Rollover just north of exit 5. It took the engine out of the north end with two firefighters on it. It took the ambulance out of headquarters with two firefighters on it, and also took the heavy rescue. So we have 9 people assigned to the community to protect it today. That one rollover on the interstate left 2 people on one engine in the south end of town.
And there's a lot of reasons for that. I mean, technology and industry are 2 of the reasons. You know, we've been called upon to do more things than years ago, like confined space rescue. I mean, I can't tell you how often that, you know, a dispatcher will say, Cap, they're doing a confined space at Stonyfield. They're doing a confined space. What's that mean? That means that if that guy gets trapped in that confined space, that man-wear tank, I'm going to need 10 guys to pull off that rescue. Otherwise, I got to call in mutual aid. You know, it's a labor-intensive job. There's no way around it. You know, even as Doug spoke about the motor vehicle accidents, automobile technology has changed. The cars are designed to keep people in. We're having to cut people out of cars. It's labor-intensive. So, and it's not a small town. It's 42 square miles. So, I mean, that's the challenge is... The chief spoke about, you know, even the working fire assignment. We tried to get as creative as we can. Working fire assignment, dead man's the ambulance, so we can bring the fire trucks to the fire, and we rely on the closest ambulance to come in, in the closest engine. So we've tried a lot of things, but gentlemen, to be honest with you, we're really at capacity. We're at capacity right now with our staffing, with our call volume. Right now, the call volume is 3,200 calls a year. We only see it going up.
Can I get the next question with Tom? Yeah.
Don. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks for being here tonight, guys. I know that some of this is difficult and to recount, especially go through minute by minute, it's probably jarring some memories that probably kept you up several nights. I think it's important to keep a face on this issue. I think we have to remember Fran and Becky Gehling. And remember, that's why we're here talking about this tonight. It's not because someone's car burned up or someone lost a garage, but we lost 2 souls, 2 fellow residents of Londonderry, and we're here to try to figure out how to mitigate, how to prevent that from happening again. And I think given the very compelling story that you've given us and the current circumstances and staffing and equipment and fire hydrants and so forth, that there's probably not much could have done to save those 2 women. But I think that there are things we can do to perhaps minimize the probability of a repeat or a like occurrence, and you've given us some ideas. I had some other questions, though. Have we got to the point where we're with the forensics, we've been able to determine the actual cause of the fire?
With the State Fire Marshal's Office, due to the extent of the fire and the damage to the area of origin, it was undetermined as an actual cause. Probable either electrical or smoking material may have been the cause, but without, you know, actually finding the, you know, smoking gun, you know, for say there was so much damage to the area. Like I said, we did find computers, electrical equipment, surge protectors in that area, but there was just too much damage to it to do any testing to find out what that was, you know, if there was any cause from that. But working with the State Fire Marshal's Office, they put in a lot of man hours helping us out with this. We are required to call them for any fatal fires, but I think they went above and beyond, you know, helping us trying to investigate this, and there was just so much damage that it was inconclusive, and their report came out as undetermined.
Can you tell us who found Becky and Fran, and when they found them, and where they found them in the structure?
That would be the, when I was relieved, I was relieved by Captain Darren O'Brien, and then he worked together jointly with the State Fire Marshal's Office and conducted that operation.
You know, can you recall where the victims were found?
The State Fire Marshal were there and doing the overhaul and the pickup, and Darren, the best of their mapping it out of where it was that Becky was found immediately underneath her bedroom, since everything had collapsed down. So they felt that she was in her bedroom. Not sure exactly, you know, what was found on him, and that Fran had made it partially down the hallway,
and then collapsed again.
And everything was found in that, but she was in the hallway somewhere, within just before the center staircase.
So was it our firefighters that did the victim recovery?
With the State Fire Marshal's Office, yes.
How are the firefighters doing in terms of PTSD or follow-up counseling? Or
we've had initial counseling at the beginning when there. We've offered it two or three times now since, and I think Darren can attest to the fact that I don't think a month goes by without something gets brought up. Is everybody doing okay?
Good to hear that.
Speak on that if you'd like. As I was one of the firefighters that was there that night, I was on the truck company. I'm 24 years old, and I've been a firefighter for 5 years now. And it was a very frustrating experience for me, because we were sent there to do a job, and we weren't able to complete that job. Now, whether it be staffing or fire hydrants or, you know, delayed notification, whatever the case may be, I was not able to complete my job that night, and those two people perished. And, you know, that weighs heavy on you. You feel like you went to your office and you didn't complete your job that night. And not a day goes by that I don't think about that, whether it was my family or, you know, a friend of mine. It's very hard. It's absolutely very hard. And the thing that's even harder is to know that if that exact same fire happened again tonight, nothing other than our run cards having more tankers on it would have changed, because engine 2 is going to still roll up tonight with only two guys on it, and engine 3 is going to roll up with only two guys on it, and the tower will roll up with only two guys on it, and engine 1 tonight will roll up with only two guys on it. And we're just putting our firefighters at a level of we're behind the eight ball, and we have to work 10 times harder. I had to set the whole tower up, the whole tower truck, by myself that night, because my partner had to go help another firefighter on a line, because the first new engine company only had two guys on it. And then I had to set the tower up and then go man another line. We're asking so much from our firefighters. And, you know, the brothers that I work with, we go to work every day, and they do a very good job. This town has probably some of the most professional and highly trained firefighters I've ever had the privilege of working with. And I can say that because I've come from a bunch of different communities. I started in Hudson, I went to Pelham, and I've landed here. And I love this department, I love this town, I look forward to moving here. But we need to handle our staffing issue. We need to give us the tools that we need to complete our job. And you know, that would be my only request as an employee of this community, as one of your firefighters, as one of the guys that's riding on the ambulance or riding on the fire truck. This town is a great town. We have phenomenal apparatus. We just need to put that one more thing together, give us the staffing that we can complete our job. Thank you.
So my assessment is there are three things here at play. The number of firefighters, that's gotten a lot of discussion. I think John mentioned the tanker.
Which I don't think is in the CIP. I don't recall it in there.
So that's something that we might want to talk about, or at least continue to investigate that. If that's a recommendation and it's not in the CIP, then we need to look at that as an option. And the third one that we haven't really spent a lot of time talking about is the fire hydrant infrastructure itself. We do have some fire hydrants in town from Penichuk and from Manchester Waterworks, but I think about 80 to 85% of the town is not covered by fire hydrants. Is that about right?
It's actually about 45%.
45%?
Yeah. It's 40, I want to say 46, 47%. Am I correct in saying that?
Is covered?
Is covered.
Yes.
Ask some questions. So how much residential is that?
So how much residential, what's the percentage of our residential community is not covered by fire hydrants?
I don't know I know the residential part is the biggest part that is uncovered. The industrial part is definitely the part with more coverage. I don't have an exact number. What percentage of residential, but there is more residential uncovered than commercial or industrial.
It's safe to say well more than half?
Oh, I'd say over half of our residential is uncovered.
So a question I think that to lie on the table is to ask or have some thought around how do we get more coverage? What are our options with our providers of the of the main lines that would feed a fire hydrant, I guess Dave, I might turn to you to maybe do some checking with maybe Penichuk and Manchester, see what would it take? Is there an investment we need to make? Is there an investment they need to make? Is it get put onto the ratepayers, or how's that paid for? I think we just need to educate ourselves around the cost and implementation of that leg of the infrastructure.
Using the 500 feet rule, right?
That's the accepted standards of 500 feet.
And the other thing, too, to consider into the discussion would be, even if we did put a tanker in place, you still need manning to get it,
right,
to get it there. So
sure.
That's one thing that we, you know, we'll have to consider. You know, what we need for staffing, how many.
That was one element on the timeline that I think stood out for me was the Litchfield tanker. I think it was around 23 minutes.
That's from the time of the call.
Which, in absolute time, seems like a snap of the finger. Seems like really quick, but in terms of measuring against a fire like that, that probably feels like forever.
It does. It does. It goes by quicker than you think. Yeah. We have made adjustments to the run cards as far as tankers, but the only thing is we're looking at, when we had a discussion about, you know, making those adjustments on the run cards, we almost need to be an equal contributor. Also, if you take, without just doing some simple math, for a not a house fire like that, but Mr. Green was talking about, you know, how many rooms, you know, let's take that fire that we had after the trench rescue. We had 1.5 rooms going, 2 rooms going, single ranch house, 500 gallons a minute is what you would need to quench that fire out. So if you looked at, when you're doing a tanker operation, is dump time, that tanker dumps, that tanker has to travel to a fill site, let's say it's 5 minutes, and we're going to flow 500 gallons a minute. So it's going to fill. It's going to take probably about maybe 4 to 5 minutes to fill. Then it's going to travel 5 minutes. And then nowadays, new tankers can dump, you know, almost 3,000 gallons within maybe a minute. So that's why when you're looking, and we've done a lot, actually, the next training that we're going to do is a house going to be acquired on Apple Tree. That's part of the Woodmont project. We're going to use that as a training burn, but we're going to do a tanker shuttle. And because we want to figure out exactly, but just doing the math for that particular training, I need 6 tankers. To flow 500 GPM, I need 6 tankers right away, you know, flowing. So what you have to do is you have to look geographically which tankers are the closest coming in, you know, that make the most sense, but you need to be a contributor too. You know what I'm saying? To really get that. And when we think of, you know, not just a fire, that's a gas leak. You know, that's like, you know, someone severs in the wintertime, they plow off a propane tank. You know, now we have to disperse vapors. We're in a non-hydrant district. We're thinking about for that. We got a hazmat situation, a decon, a brush fire. You know, there's not too many brush fires that are near hydrants. So unfortunately, we have to call for a tanker then too. So, I mean, it's something that, you know, it's another tool in the toolbox, I guess.
Do our neighborhood pools a resource that you can use in a fire?
A pool? Absolutely, you could. I mean, we have a floating pump that you can put in, but as Captain Caldwell said, you know, you may get, you know, like an above-ground pool, 10,000, or an in-ground pool is 20,000. I mean, you know, one thing about firefighters, we're innovative. If we're in a pinch and an emergency, we're going to do exactly what we need to do to make it happen.
You know? Matt, can I ask you? One thing, Captain, what I was thinking of, so I remember back when I was on the budget committee, I remember we had talked about, you know, a situation about hydrants. I don't remember the pretext of it, but I do remember that it was a very expensive venture, very, very cost ineffective, if you would. So, and one thing, at looking at the report that you guys had, it seems as though that even though we had a hydrant so far away, it still took forever to pump it out and get the water to the pressure that you needed to fight the fire. So would it be safe to say that it would make more sense initially, just me thinking right now, that a tanker truck would be the way to go, because that way you've got a truck that's going to pump X amount of gallons that you'll know you'll have. Also, it would also assist you guys in being contributors to any work in fire, whether it be in Hudson, in Derry, in Londonderry. I mean, would that be something that makes the most sense?
It would definitely be another tool in the toolbox, you know, something that we could, you know, take to the fire scene. I mean, you have to, you know, looking at a fire scene, what we said before, even just having that extra water, that allows the guys to perform those functions, you know, fire attack, search and rescue, where you're not necessarily putting that fire out, but you're holding it at bay just to let the search and rescue continue and rescue the life from the house.
And you're not waiting for the other guys to get there.
Exactly.
You still brought up the same point, is that it's staffing that gets it there.
Doug, I completely understand that. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm asking about
the tanker, absolutely.
Exactly. That's what I'm asking. I'm just trying to resolve that in my head. The manning issue, I get that. I understand that. But
since you touched on mutual aid, we'll just cover it real quick. 2007, 154 total mutual aid requests. Most of them were about 50-50, in and out. 2008, 187. Same thing, about in and out. Then we make this huge jump. In 2009, we go to 290. 2009, 290. 2010, 256. Most of those they're more received than we provide. And right now, year to date, we're at 166. And there again, there's a larger percentage received. We're drawing more on our mutual aid partners than we're providing. So, and that is a lot of the day-to-day stuff, including, you know, tankers to brush fires, ambulances to motor vehicle accidents, whether it be on the highway or town roads, and just straight medicals. Those secondary calls. We cannot cover all the calls that we have. So those secondary calls are being covered by mutual aid engines, mutual aid ambulances. And so just to give you an idea where those numbers are at.
John, sorry.
Just two quick things, please. Yeah. One is the CIP isn't finalized until October 12th, so if you guys want to talk to Andre, you can probably get something on it still before it gets the final proposal. Just so it's in the, you know, at least we get the tanker in the hopper and at least it becomes part of a conversation.
Well, we can discuss it real quick. Back in the early 2000s was...
Doug. just put the money in, and let's just get it in there so it becomes part of a discussion going forward. We're not going to solve it here tonight. You know that.
No, I know we're not going to solve it, but if you look at the capital apparatus, the capital improvement program is broken down between ambulances and fire trucks. Both of them are bracketed within months. The funding has been reduced due to the economic times. I mean, we're looking at a request for next fiscal year is $300,000 for the apparatus capital improvement program. Last year they put in $145,000. So we're asking for, you know, a double increase, you know, to keep that going as it is, not even adding a tanker into that mix. So.
Okay. All right. With that in mind, the other thing I'd like to suggest is that this is the staffing of the fire department is bigger than us. So I'd like the council to kind of noodle on an idea. Let's put a question to the voters. Let's put it on the ballot. Let's put a question to the voters. We need to figure out exactly how to do that and say, should we increase staffing of the Londonderry Fire Department from this to X? And let's let the residents weigh in. If they want to increase the fire department by 8 firefighters, I don't know, I'm picking a number. All right, it is at a cost of this, and here's what it is on the tax rate. Non-binding question. And let's get an opinion, find out what they want to do. If the residents of the town want to add firefighters, then I think our direction is clear. If they don't want to add firefighters, then our direction is clear. But I think it's bigger than the five of us.
But the problem with that is if they come back and say yes, then we have to wait a year to do it.
Well, actually, we can put the money in the budget, and if they say yes, we can still do it.
Or
if they say no, we take it out.
Or we can act like grown-ups and either do it or not do it. You know, that's what we've supposedly been elected for. I mean, why don't we just go home, John? You know, and we'll just do everything by plebiscite. You know, frankly, if it's a problem,
I'll make a motion right now that we hire 8 firefighters and we put it into next year's budget.
No, but I'd like to look at some idea about doing something that's realistic, that we can get past the voters.
But, you know,
because we can make a motion, we could put 8 firefighters on and maybe the voters say no. But maybe if we come at it with a reasonable thing, and you know, you're not going to get 20 guys, and you know that, you know. You know, maybe you get 4, maybe you get 5 or 6 or something like that, or maybe you get, you know, 4 in a tanker. But I'm here to do something that's realistic, and that's
fine.
What I like.
But hold on.
It's an idea.
Hold on.
Okay,
yeah,
it is.
Guys, time out. So, realistically, John was just throwing an idea. So
right.
All right.
We have a deliberative
back
session.
It up a
we
second.
Can do that.
Back it up a second. Okay. Go ahead.
And that, you know, a variant of that idea is to put a warrant article out and let the deliberative session deliberate on it, and which would put it in the next available budget or not, depending on how they deliberate.
You know, I'll take my turn at it. You know, for years and years, and I was telling myself I wasn't going to say this because I'm going to take a lot of crap for it. I know I'm going to. The years and years, the town has always been asked to cut, to streamline, to hold back, while the other pocket has been just consistently going up. I'm being nice. And all I'm trying to think of is that, out of fairness, while I understand education is really important, so isn't safety to the citizens. And we have asked our departments on the town side for years to do more with less. And I've been one of the ones challenging them that to do that too. But I guess the one thing that has irked me through the years of sitting here is that we've done that, and at what cost? Well, the other pocket just keeps spending and spending and spending. And I realize that things over on the other side cost a lot of money. But I guess to my point is wouldn't it be nice if we got a break from that side and they held the line while we had to spend a little more on this side so we can bring some things up to snuff? And I'm just throwing that out there. And I know I'm going to take a lot of heat for it, but I had to say that because I've been thinking it for a long time.
In the end, though, it's all up to the voters.
On
both sides.
Very true.
But I think if we look at just something that's historical, that's in the town's annual report every year. There's a page there that has a 10-year staffing history of the town. And you could look at it from 2010 and go back 10 years, and it's flat. You exclude the airport division, and there hasn't been more than three or four people up and down. And on and I think it's the same as it was 10 years ago. It's 110 people or something like that. And we can all sit here and say that that's great, but let's not ignore the fact that we've got 1,000 more houses than we had 10 years ago. We've got I don't know how many new businesses. I don't know how many roads, but 1,000 houses is a lot. And to think that, you know, it's not proportional, I'm sure. You could, you know, if 100 houses were added, maybe you don't need an extra fireman or policeman. But at some point, there's a break-even point. And I think maybe we've hit it, because now we have apparatus that are unmanned, and and with all due respect to you guys, I understand the NFPA, but nobody's going to fund that. So we got to do what we can do, because we're not going to have a 50% increase in 1 year in the fire department's budget. So, but we can do something. I think we should do something. I think it's irresponsible not to at least try. And I hope we can try to do something in the town budget.
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah, Jim.
Just to state the obvious, I think. Maybe I'm just in Disney World somewhere here, but everything that I read when this first came out and everything that I saw today, guys, you guys are waiting for water. I mean, I don't know. Not hitting it? I mean, no, you guys are waiting for water. You guys had water that were on trucks. You had mutual aid that came in, and it really wasn't effective because you didn't have the water. I think, you know, everything keeps saying water, 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 and I understand
that's part of the problem.
That you said the tanker would be somewhat of a help, but you mentioned a few minutes ago that 7 tankers would have been needed to put out one of the fires.
6 tankers to flow 500 GPM.
Yep.
Which it kind of exceeded that fire.
Okay.
Yeah.
But my point is, I guess, on this water hydrant thing, you guys are really talking about personnel, and I just wanted to kind of point it out that I think the biggest issue right now is water hydrants, too. I don't know he talked about pumping water out of a pool, but do you guys also have an indication of where the closest body of water would be?
Yes.
As well, and if you could map that, I mean, I guess part of some kind of plan might be also to see where the closest bodies of water would be so that you could pump that water. I mean, again, I don't know how many times I could say it.
I will tell you this.
It says more about water than it says about anything else to me.
All of that's mapped out. We have cisterns. We have bodies of water. It still requires a piece of apparatus to put into that, draw the water out of it, and deliver it somewhere else. And it's manpower intensive. Everything we do on the fire ground or off the fire ground is manpower intensive. Okay. Even if we had hydrants every 500 feet, still takes a truck to lay the line to deliver the water.
See, the overhead was put together, but I read the actual report, and mm-hmm. as you go through this report, I don't know if it's just me, anybody else that's read the report, but it seemed like there was an awful lot of time trying to get that hose laid and an awful lot of time communicating with the people that were trying to lay that hose to get water to the fire. So I know you guys all want to talk about personnel, and I'm happy to talk about personnel, but I'm very interested in the water situation right now. It scares me to hear 60-70% of the, I'm just throwing a number out there, 60-70% of the community residential does not have a hydrant around. So you're talking about a worse scenario. Well, can't be a worse scenario, same scenario. You're talking about a fire you can't control. If you have 7 pump trucks there, every mutual aid in town comes to that one fire, you're not putting it out. I mean, you may be able to get in there to save somebody, God willing, but you're not gonna have a prayer if you don't have a water hydrant. This water hydrant, fortunately, was 819 away.
Yeah.
And you're telling me that 70% of it, the town, wouldn't be that fortunate to have that water.
Correct.
So that's very, very scary. I know we're talking a lot about personnel, but I don't want to, you know, kind of press that aside. I don't know what the solution is. I don't know how many millions of dollars it would take to try to get a better percentage, but that's something we have to look at as well.
Councilor Green, your point is very well taken, and you're correct in saying it. The one thing with the manpower is that we're afraid of, take this same house, not an extreme case, say we said 25% involved, 30% involved, it's really, we would have with 4,000 gallons of water, you know, 3,000 getting there, it's applying it, it's the application. So keeping it at 25%, you know, we said basically keeping a small fire small, that's where we've been successful. Unfortunately, those fires, that the fire that we talked about after the trench rescue, that newspaper article was this big, okay? A lot of you probably never even saw it, you know what I mean? But that was hitting it with manpower, I mean, 1,000 gallons a minute. I mean, really, it's the application of water on that fire.
So I don't want to try to pretend to be a firefighter, but you had that apparatus that was way up in the sky.
Yeah.
All right, and you have a fire hydrant attached to that thing, and you knock the fire down. I mean, if you that's your solution, right? I mean, that's
absolutely.
That's the first thing you do. You see, I'm just pretending I'm a fire guy for a minute. You see, it's involved. You get that truck out there, and you get that hydrant that's only 200 feet away, and you got a tremendous pressurized fire hydrant. I think you're, you know, even four men at that point doing that truck. You said it was one person who set it up.
Yeah.
So four men on that, that's what I'm saying. I mean, I understand there's a good combination, but without the water, you can have 20 people running around.
But right, but unfortunately, that's a defensive fire. I wish they were all like that.
Yeah.
My job would be pretty easy. You know, it'd be a very easy job for me if they were all like that. In a defensive fire, it's an offensive fire when we're going in, where I need two guys to go in on a hose line, two guys search and rescue, two guys backup, ventilation. That's what's going to make the difference. This fire was an exception, but it's that fire that's in your neighborhood where, you know, we show up with you know, early notification, and we got three guys on engine two, and I can get in your house.
And 2,500 gallons to get started on it.
Exactly. I mean, I understand what you're saying, that the safer we are, the better off we're going to be, but it's really having it. It's labor intensive. I mean, you know what, we've taken advantage of, I mean, you know, through Dave Karen and working together, we've taken advantage of every possible grant. We have Class A foam. Class A foam helps the water do a better job, breaks down the surface tension. We have thermal imaging cameras. All the technology, I mean, we've been as responsible fiscally as we possibly can as far as grant funding and everything we can do. I mean, even at Safer Grant, we came so close with that. But we're getting to a point where, you know, we have all the technology, but unfortunately, it's still labor intensive.
I'm just afraid because you know I'm paying $25 for early, you know, $25 a month for all of my smoke detectors and all of my heat sensors to call you guys as soon as they get that. And if I don't have a hydrant around my, I know I'm stuck on it. I understand that, but if I don't have a hydrant, how are you going to put it out?
Well, you need if I may, you need enough water to
get started
to hold the fire long enough to do a search and rescue.
Absolutely.
Get the people out.
Right.
Let the building burn. I mean, people out.
But if Councilor Green is correct in everything he said, if his, you know, your smoke detectors are updated and you got battery backup, and it's going to go off, you and your family are going to exit quickly. You're going to call us.
Right.
I mean, that's one of the longest runs we have. That's in the most southwest corner of the town is 38 Hemlock Street. I mean, our average run, Ryan, what's the average run? 4 minutes?
4 minutes.
Over 4 minutes. If I can put 12 guys on scene in 4 minutes, and, you know, even if you haven't gotten out of the house yet, I mean, I'm showing up with 3,000 gallons of water with 12 guys. My strategy and tactics are pretty strong. My guys are well-trained.
Believe me, I'm out of the house. I don't have to even call you. My fire alarm called you automatically, so I don't have to worry.
If you know, we're going to come in and get you.
So, Joe, just no pictures of how much fire we knocked down when we first got there. When engine two got there, they pulled an engine
three-quarter, but when the tower and the engine three got there, we pulled a 2.5. And if engine two had rolled with three guys, engine two could have pulled a 2.5. Engine three could have pulled a 2.5. And the amount of fire that we knocked down with the 2.5 and the engine 3/4, there was if there was pictures to see of the first 4 minutes of the fire, if somebody was there to take pictures of the first 4 minutes, we knocked down a considerable amount of fire. Our problem was we didn't have enough manpower to continue knocking down the fire. And we ran out of the water too. But the amount of fire we knocked down with that first 3,000 gallons of water was considerable.
You were out of water in 10 minutes, right?
Yeah, we were.
So can I ask for consensus? Can we direct the town manager to ask the fire chief to add, we're not getting the four from the SAFER grant, to add four personnel into the budget that he presents us so that we can see what the cost is?
Absolutely. Yes. And just Joe, just so you realize, the hydrant option has been looked at. It's not a good option, and I'm going to tell you why. Because it costs a fortune. We outlined it back, Dave, how many years ago? We looked at the hydrants. How much does it cost for a hydrant?
Well, just the rental is, what, $600 a year, but that's minimal compared to the extension costs, which I have to research for Tom.
Right, that's what we ran into.
And I just like us to take a look at it one more time, if that's okay. I mean, if there's research already done, updated, it shouldn't take too long just to take a look at it.
That's fine, but to what I'm hearing from the guys tonight is this. They need more personnel to fight the fires, to be able to do their jobs more adequately. And they need a blast of water en route with them to do it so that they can get in there, try and help to save lives if they can. And then everything else happens after everybody's out, and then they can just try and fight the fire. And
I just want to make sure we're keeping it to the three-prong approach that Councilor Dolan mentioned earlier, because I think it is three different areas we have to look at and evaluate each area.
I'm just telling you,
yep.
We've done that, but doing the diligence again is not a big deal. Okay, so
I don't know, did we get a consensus?
Yeah,
I'm good with it.
All right, well, I have a citizen out there that has his hand up, so he wants to say something. So, Don?
Don Moskowitz, 7 Tokenel Drive. Getting back to the water situation, it looked to me like it took about 40 minutes before there was pressurized water available to the firefighters. In addition to that, it took 31 minutes for the Litchfield tanker to be become available.
23,
but still that's a long time. And then you said, what, there's 2,500 or 3,000 gallons available in one of these tankers?
Yes, well, a tanker can be spec'd any way you want. The first new tanker was the Litchfield tanker at 2,500 gallons.
Okay. Well, to me, and I'm just a layman when it comes to this, that still doesn't seem like a lot of water. Well, I have a 20,000-gallon above-ground pool, and it took two tanker trucks to fill that pool. Which obviously means there's 10,000 gallons on each one of those trucks. Now, I'm not talking about the same type of tanker that you're talking about. I'm talking about one of those big pool trucks. Why don't we consider purchasing one or more of those pool trucks, which will have 10,000 gallons each? You might even want to look at used trucks. I know you want to buy new, and you want to don't want the upkeep and all, but I see these pool trucks roaming around the town and other towns all the time, and you might be able to purchase a couple of used pool trucks with 10,000 gallons each, which will give you 20,000 gallons to fight a fire.
And I'm sure they'd get there sooner than 35 minutes or whatever it was, right?
Well, exactly. They'd be housed at your fire station, one at Central Fire Station, one at another fire station. Or who knows? You might be able to buy three used pool trucks for 30,000 gallons.
Thank you.
Sean, would you like me to answer that?
Please.
25 years ago, we had a single tractor trailer in headquarters. It came down to one, maintenance. A lot of money, more axles, and the amount of trained drivers we had to deploy it. It came down to two people who were actually tractor trailer trained, and to keep their licenses up. It got to the point where the truck was too expensive to maintain, plus the drivers. We went to a two tanker system. We bought some used apparatus. We fabricated our own tanks. We actually, one got involved in a motor vehicle accident at the intersection of Mammoth Road and 102. That's where we started going back, you know, we're not going to build fire apparatus. We're going to go to a manufacturer, and, you know, we've been using, you know, people, that's their job to do is build fire apparatus, and that's who's been supplying them for us.
was. Why don't they build it bigger? 2,500 doesn't sound like a lot, even to what we just talked about.
You can build them bigger, but it comes down to how much weight can you take over the road safely.
It's a DOT.
I imagine in the wintertime you have to keep that truck inside, or else the water has danger of freezing.
Yeah, actually, when those trucks pump off their water, they pretty much go, and if the roads are frozen, that's where they sit until you get water back in them. Maybe they'll spin their tires and auto chains and lights.
Gone
down that road before.
Well, so. One thing I'd just like to say, I know most of your backgrounds, and you're all intelligent men. When you go home to your house tonight, right, length times width, right? Length times width divided by 3, times it by whatever percentage of involvement you have in your house. That's how much you need to put it out. You'd be surprised, it's very little. You know what I mean? This fire was an exception. What I think Councilor Keefe hit the nail on the head. Give us just that extra added amount of water for 90% of those fires so we can do the fire ground functions that Chief McCaffrey spoke of. Search and rescue, ventilation, fire attack. You know, really, when you add it up, I mean, even a large-scale commercial building, you know, if you had, just add up just length times width, divide it by 3, times it by whatever, and then by how many floors, that's what we do in our head, and that's how we figure. Most of the fires that we fight are 200 gallons a minute, 200 gallons, some are even less. I mean, a room and contents fire is probably about 50 gallons a minute, and that's where it comes in with the people. With the people, so we can get that line, we get in, and we keep that small fire small, we get in. It's easy math, but we have to do it on the fly. That's how we figure out how much resources to call for. It's a fire ground formula is what we use. But just to put in perspective, when something is at that extent, or large fires that we've had, you know, like the Woodmore fire years ago, I mean, there's nothing you're going to do. I mean, unfortunately.
It was all crates.
Exactly.
Yeah. That was one big kindling.
Right.
Yeah, but I also think Council Green brought up a great point. I know this is going to be my little public service announcement here, but making sure your smoke detectors work. You know, they're to be replaced in the home every 10 years. You know, we go into homes all the time. You know, my smoke detector's chirping. How long's it been there? 25 years. You know, every 10 years, replace the smoke detector. You know, make sure that the batteries are changed twice a year, test them once in a while, do home fire drills. I mean, all these things make a difference. You know, having an alarm system is a wonderful thing. Delayed notification has had a large effect on some of our larger fires. The sooner we get notified, the sooner we get on the road.
Yeah, I was surprised to hear that all that's required is a battery operated. When we did an addition, we had to put electrical and all wired, and it all had to be hardwired.
Any new construction has to have hardwired with battery backup and carbon monoxide detectors on every floor.
I missed that. What was it?
Every new construction has to have hardwired smoke detectors on every level, inside the bedroom and outside each sleeping area. Carbon monoxide detector on every level as well.
I'm going to get tomatoes thrown at me, but I'd like to suggest to the community that everybody does that. I mean, just should be required, actually.
I recommend it to people. Any new construction, like I said, has to have that. Hopefully the people listening tonight, you know, like I said, you do a home fire drill, test your smoke detectors, make sure you have enough. The biggest thing is getting the people out of the home. You know, if you're notified early enough, you can get out of the home, dial 911, get the guys on the road.
I understand there's some new science around the talking smoke detectors as opposed to the beeping ones, did some effectiveness increase?
They're finding out, especially with children, the voice smoke detectors and carbon monoxide detectors are much more effective. There's been different studies out there where they'll set off smoke detectors. The kids pull the blankets over their head and go back to sleep. They have the new ones now that will actually say fire when there's a fire, or carbon monoxide when there's carbon monoxide. We have places here in town that sell the combination unit. I mean, whether you have hardwired or battery, they're great units to have. But the voice-activated ones actually get people's attention better out of the, in a deep sleep. And they're finding, especially with children, they get them up a lot better than just the noise activated.
Yeah, I think it's because in my house, I mean, you start to fry up anything that's a little bit charred and things starts going off everywhere, and because it's all hooked in,
yeah,
now you're having like 30 alarms everywhere all over the place going off, and people are yelling at me because I'm always burning things.
Nice save.
Well, there's ways around that too. If you put an ionization detector in the kitchen, that's not as susceptible as going off as a photoelectric detector for that type of fire. So there's different heads that you can use to sort of eliminate that false alarm, and that way they, you know, because exactly, we go into homes and the smoke detectors are gone because, well, I took it down because it's always going off. You know, maybe you're better off putting up the different type of detector.
So you mean it'll say, stupid, you're burning the bacon?
No, no, it's just, like I said, one is more for a small smoldering fire, one is for a rapid fire. So depending on the type of smoke, whether it goes off, you know, if one's rated better for kitchens than, you know, obviously a sleeping area.
Right. And should anybody have any questions, just give us a call. We'll come down and give you a hand, figuring it out.
So bring it back to the council. So John made a motion, and or a consensus, I should say. So, John, can we get back on that again? What was your consensus you wanted?
I thought we voted already.
No. Did we?
But everybody said yes to tell Dave to...
Okay. I didn't know if we completed that or not.
To direct the fire chief to add four people because...
To the budget.
Because
yeah.
We didn't get the funding for the SAFER grant so that we can see what the effect is on the tax rate.
Okay.
And get an understanding of what the cost is to give the fire department what they need to be able to increase the services they give now.
And also the CIP for adding in a water pumper.
Well, that's something, I don't know, is that something you can handle with Andre?
Yeah, we can ask him to take a look at that.
And see if it's specifically, make sure that Doug is, what Doug is saying is that, hey, I allocate $300,000 a year. We cut it to 140. I don't know what a pumper costs, a tanker costs. So maybe we just need to find that out and make sure we've allocated enough money. Would that cover that?
Yeah, basically what it comes down to, when we first looked at capital plans, we were only looking 6 years out. Well, we replace trucks every 12 to 15 years. So it didn't show a lot of our apparatus. So, you know, we can par that number down. We asked for $250,000. Now we'll par it down to 170-ish, you know. You know, the number changes. But when you start looking at a 25-year plan with that type of rollover, you're looking at, you know, $300,000-$400,000 a year that we need to at least put away for fire apparatus. Doesn't mean you need to buy it.
And that doesn't have any special requirements as far as driving it, right?
The
basically,
tanker?
That's anybody on staff can drive that truck?
I mean, if you're looking at a 2,500 or 3,000 gallon tanker, anybody on staff would be able to drive that, correct? No, with no additional training.
The one standard that we meet in the fire service that everybody has to meet, because they won't sell a fire truck, it's NFPA 1901, and that's the standard. They won't even sell. Am I correct in saying that?
If we buy a fire truck from a manufacturer and we don't want it NFPA certified, we have to sign a liability waiver, and we won't do that.
Yeah, there's really no way we can do it. I mean, every fire truck, whether it's small town USA to New York City, they're all NFPA, and they're for a reason. They're for the safety, you know, of the employee, and then also for systems to the safety of the citizens that are driving out on the road also.
Okay. All right, Dave, so you have your marching instructions.
I do.
Is there anything else the council wants to add?
Yeah, actually, I wanted to... not the most popular thing, but I also wanted to look into accommodation, you know, try to take a look at the towns maybe that are surrounding us. I know they're smaller, but I don't want to give up the fact that there could be accommodation, people out there that maybe want to volunteer and could volunteer, and just let's put it out there and see what we get. I mean, it may not be something that people out in the audience want to hear about right now, but maybe the general public would be interested in it. So
are you talking about expanding the call force as it stands now?
Yeah, as you know, we heard from a couple of people we interviewed, actually, is entire suburbs that have volunteer firefighters that seem to work out pretty well. So maybe it's a different world in New York City, but I mean, that woman said that it was all volunteer, if I recall, wasn't it, John?
Those communities had all volunteer fire departments. They had full hydrants everywhere. And I want to say this with absolutely the most respect that I can.
Mm-hmm.
and I don't want it to come off the wrong way, but outside of the city in the outlying areas when they had the volunteer fire departments, sadly, they referred to those guys as the cellar savers. And that what they would have to do is they would have to respond to, and it's a horrible label, but they have to respond, then go get, they drive their own vehicles, then they get the trucks, then they come. They don't get there for 20 minutes, so there's really not a, for them to do. What you would wind up on a rescue situation was is some of the EMTs possibly, or the frontline policemen would be the initial rescuers in a rescue personnel in a fire. I mean, we can ask that woman, but I don't really, it's an all-volunteer fire department, obviously is not what we're talking about. Finding the right volunteers when you have an airport and a highway, I don't know. I mean, I think it's a great idea to see if there's more people that want to get involved.
Yep.
I just don't know if that's what they think would work best. I just don't know the answer. It's certainly worth looking into.
We have kind of grown through that scenario. 25 years, we had more volunteers than we did to have permanent men. There was 5 permanent men on duty. What happened was is our call volume went from 400 to 500 calls a year to 4,000 calls a year. And they just have the time to respond, to train, and when they got home from work, they wanted to spend time with their families. And you asked about our own firefighters coming back. You know, some of them that have the ability to live in town have, you know, if they're running 20 calls in their 24 hours, they're exhausted. You know, they're going home to go to bed because they're going to come back again the next day. So one of your questions was, did they come back? No, because they know they're working 20 calls tomorrow. So we're doing a lot with very little. And I know what you're saying. And if we can pull it off, you know, it might work.
So I'm not saying don't do it. I'm just saying know that you get a lot of restrictions.
Yeah, we got to look at both ways. We have a fiscal responsibility. I mean, we just talked about, you know, we talked about the safety and the fact that, you know, this situation that happened isn't burning in all of our hearts, but at the same time, you know, there's a fiscal responsibility too to look at. And to me, if you have the money in the budget, there's going to be people that are going to fill the jobs. But if you don't have the money in the budget, maybe there'll be people that would do the job anyway. And that's the reason why volunteer firefighters actually came about in the first place. I'm not talking about call firefighters. I'm talking about people manning a station. When something like this happens, they're going to be called. And there could be 4 or 5 or 6 people there. And those people could help.
Councilor Green, I mean, you do make a good point, but the standards have changed also. But the fire doesn't know who's coming, nor the confined space rescue, nor the hazmat, nor whatever motor vehicle accident, vehicle extrication. But the standards are the same, though. They still have to provide physicals. I'm still going to do pre-polygraphs and polygraphs. That's what you're going to do. You're still going to outfit that firefighter. You can't treat a call or a volunteer firefighter any different than you treat any of our other firefighters. Same gear, same physical, same process. It's going to be the same way. Otherwise, I mean, back in the old days, I mean, I was a call firefighter in Pelham. The gear that they used to give me, I think it was flammable. You know, I used to have wool mittens, and they'd send me into a fire.
Because they didn't like you.
Yeah, I know. It didn't work, you know, but I mean, we used to do a lot of things we shouldn't have did. You know, the call volunteer, if they could keep up a certification and pass that with us, that would be great. That would be a great option. I'll tell you, we hired most of our firefighters. Most of our firefighters we hired from the call force, you know, back then, young kids that went through. But, you know, basically the standards have changed. I mean, nowadays, I mean, even the call firefighters, we're going to have to put them through pre-polygraphs and polygraphs. I mean, it's our town policy. So, I mean, I don't think it's as cost-effective as you think for what we get out. If we're taking somebody who lived in town and that was their primary job, say if they lived in town and they could come to the fire station all the time and make 80% of the calls, I think you'd probably have a great idea there. You know, it would be effective. But just from what we've seen, you know, just the change in tides over the years.
Well, one of the things history's taught us is that we put our time and effort and train and equip this person, they quickly realize that now I'm a trained firefighter and I can go get a full-time job somewhere else, and they quickly leave. So that history has taught us that as well. So, I mean, you look about equipping them, $4,000. You want to train them to comparable to a full-time firefighter, what, $4,000 or $5,000 on top of that, not talking pay. We're just talking classes and equipment. So it's quite an investment for one person.
But if you have the right person, if it's the right person in town, I would say more power to it. You know, if they can manage that with their job and working for the right person, it would probably work.
Believe me, I don't want this to sound like it's a dig, but I mean, I've seen what FTE cost, and believe me, I would never do your jobs. I would never be able to do it. With all due respect, you guys are just heroes out there. But you know, putting an FTE, one FTE versus training maybe 6 or 7 volunteers, probably equal dollars. So. Something to look at. That's all I'm asking. I'm just looking to get some more information back. Dave, would you be able to do that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, appreciate it.
Okay, anything else from the council? No. All right. Gentlemen, thank you very much for your input.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having us.
Thank you very much for having to revisit this again and going through it again, and I know it was pretty tough for you guys, and I do appreciate you coming out tonight and going over everything with us. Thank you,
Council.
Thanks very much.
Okay, that wraps up old business. We have any new business, Dave?
Nope, not.
Okay, approval of minutes, council meeting of 9/19.
Motion is presented in our packet.
Second motion.
Okay. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed? Chair votes affirmative, 5-0. Other business, liaison reports, and
Elderly Affairs is missed the CIP, so they're trying to revisit with Andre about adding in things. I don't know how that's going. They're looking at a new piece of property. The one that's next to the Triangle Mobile, Gene Gagnon's piece that is just south of it, they're looking at that as a piece of property for the senior housing that they want to build. And the Airport Authority meets this Thursday, so we'll see what comes out of that. So that's it for me.
Thanks, Joe. Tom? Joe?
I missed my meeting, sorry.
No. There was a Heritage Commission meeting. There was no agenda. It adjourned as soon as the people got there. I did not attend. Let's see. That's it for liaison reports. Town manager?
Yeah, just one thing. Your regular schedule calls you to meet again next week. Currently, I have nothing on the agenda, so I know you gentlemen have met 3 weeks in a row. If you want to, we can meet next week. I think I have one thing on the agenda I can push off, or we can meet again on the 17th of October, whatever your pleasure is.
Dave, we just want to spend more time with you.
Oh, that's okay.
I would.
Yeah, I'm good with the 17th.
I mean, we're in the middle of budget preparation. Got to get into a pretty heavy next couple
17th,
weeks.
17th, so.
Okay. Dave, you have a consensus of 5 that we're more than willing to give up our Monday night to be with you. But if you insist on not having it, we'll be there. Anyway. Okay, so that's that. So our next meeting will be the 17th of October?
Right.
Okay. Board committee reappointments, appointments. We handled that earlier. So I'd take a motion to adjourn if we
meeting to adjourn.
So moved.
Yes, sir.
From the dispatch committee.
Yep.
Ed Nolan, I appreciate Mr. Frieder nominating me. Will we be notified of each other's phone numbers? And potential meeting dates, Margo.
I can't help you with meeting dates, but telephone numbers and all pertinent information. You
should get this started.
I have a packet for you to fill out.
Outstanding.
You folks, when you have your first meeting, decide when you're going to have all your subsequent meetings.
Once you get together, you'll nominate a chair, a vice chair, secretary.
You'll be contacted.
And one last question. Since it's a committee appointed by the town council, mm-hmm. do we have to post notices that it's a public meeting?
Yes. Mm-hmm. You will be required. Absolutely.
All normal
stuff. And besides, to add to that, you do definitely want to get the public input.
Yeah, you have some educated town staff on the committee that will come equipped with what all the requirements are for meeting noticing and all that.
Outstanding. Thank you.
Thank you, Ed. And John, you'd like to speak?
Yes, John Bellicat, 37 Heritage. Thank you for the vote of confidence
and I will do a very good job, I'm sure. I damn sure try. And, it was a great idea to have the people come. I wish they all have come and listened to this tonight. Because for those who aren't doing this as a way of life, it really already puts 9 or 10 big key points for analysis up on the board. So, thanks again.
Thank you, John.
Thanks for coming.
Okay. Motion to adjourn?
Maybe we had that.
You had that?
Yeah,
it's on the floor?
Yeah, I did.
Take a vote.
Yep.
We'll get a vote now? Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed?
Aye.
Or adjourn?
Who did the second?
Aye.